Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I remind everyone to switch their electronic devices to silent. We have apologies from Eleanor Whittam, and I welcome back Karen Adam as her substitute. Our first item today is consideration of a negative instrument. The Charges for Residue Surveillance Amendment Scotland Regulations 2024, SSI 2024/218. Do any members wish to make any comment on this instrument? Rhoda. Yeah.
I'm just a bit concerned about it, and I wonder if an island impact assessment has been made. There's a movement to try and get micro abattoirs onto our islands. And while they're maybe not there yet, I just wonder if the costs associated with this instrument makes that a more distant hope.
Okay, thank you. Rachel?
Thank you. I'm just raising the DPLR comments from Tim Eagle on the increase in financial cost. I'm slightly concerned about that. Don't think we have enough information around that. And the deficit that's leading into 2029. I also want to know how it will affect, for example, game processing plants and milk processing plants and slaughterhouses, and really understand the impact of this.
Okay, thank you. Certainly, I have some concerns about why we're seeing such a big increase in potential cost from 5 million to 8 million, whether what that's actually down to, operating costs, veterinary costs, I don't think there's enough information in the papers that we have today to make a decision. Can I propose that we move this agenda item for consideration to next week, when we have the Minister in front of us to deal with two other pieces of subordinate legislation and make a decision then? Are we agreed?
Evidence that has been submitted so far. There are two bits of evidence that are anonymous, and I wondered also whether, as a committee, we should reach out to anyone else that's been affected prior to meeting with the Minister.
I'm going to look to my clerks. I don't know whether over such a short time scale that might be difficult. But we could certainly, on the back of the information we get to the Minister, make further decisions on how we proceed.
It's on the record now anyway, Convener. Okay. So if people pick it up, and those who are affected by this particular SSI, then I think they can contact the committee.
Okay, that's fine. So everybody agreed that we push this agenda item to next week? Okay, thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session as part of our follow-up inquiry to salmon farming in Scotland. Today's session is about marine spatial planning and consenting processes. We have around 90 minutes for discussion this morning, and welcome to the meeting Mark Harvey from the planning team in the Highland Council, Ronan O'Hara, the Chief Executive of Crown Estates Scotland, and remotely Rachel Shucksmith, the Marine Spatial Planning Manager from the University of the Highlands and Islands. I also welcome Edward Mountain, who will be taking part in the discussion. Mr Mountain, do you have any declaration of interest?
Thank you, Convener, and I do. I'd like to remind members that I have an interest in a wild salmon fishery on the River Spey, which is on the east coast of Scotland. As such, it is not affected by fish farms along the coast of the east, along the east coast of Scotland. My interest in the fishing employs three full-time people, and I think that's probably covered it. Any details that anyone else wants is in my register of interest.
Thank you. So I'm going to kick off. We've got a number of themes, and our first theme is reforming consent towards a single framework. So my question is, how has the planning and consenting regime for salmon farms changed since the publication of the REC committee report? Go to you first, Mark.
Okay. Well, I suppose the biggest change that's occurred has been the relatively recent one of CEPA becoming the main regulator for wild fish interactions. So that's largely to do with sea lice interactions with wild fish. That's quite a big difference as far as planners are concerned. That was an area that we gave considerable attention to and sort of initiated the use of environmental management plans, which was basically encouraging a system of wild fish monitoring as a way of assessing impacts. I have to say that that was that was successful in terms of getting fish farm interests, operators and fishery boards, rivers trusts, talking to each other and discussing ways of monitoring. I think it left a lot to be desired scientifically and its effectiveness. So I think the movement of CEPA into that role and going about it in the way that CEPA does, you know, scientifically based, evidence based procedure is a big change. And probably that would be the biggest one from our point of view, from planners' point of view.
Okay. Anyone else come on to that, Ronan?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Committee. I think from the perspective of Crown Estate Scotland, which is, of course, a public corporation, but not a regulator in the traditional definition, we come at this very much from the perspective of a landlord managing the seabed asset on behalf of the people of Scotland. my team continued to collaborate and work in a fashion to support the changes that are being progressed and as described by Mark, and we'll continue to actively contribute and add value where we can.
Okay, Rachel, I'm going to come to you. Can I also ask if what you believe that the current challenges are around aquaculture planning and consenting, and what further improvements would help with the current regime to address them? Rachel.
thank you. From my perspective as a marine planner, I imagine it was expected by now that there would have been a greater rollout of regional marine planning, which might have influenced the development of aquaculture and other industries in our marine regions, particularly in the Highlands and Islands. And that process has been probably slower than anticipated. That said, Orkney is currently in the consultation process of their regional marine plan in Shetland. We're hoping for it to be adopted by ministers before the end of this financial year. And that might provide somewhat of a greater steer for aquaculture development in the future and help to reduce conflicts.
So one of the key recommendations from the REC committee report was to have a more integrated and coordinated framework approach to consenting. And one of those solutions from the consenting task group was to pilot a four-stage process. Can I ask Rachel, I'll start with you again, what's your experience of that? Is it working or just generally what's your thoughts on the four-stage process?
I imagine there will be regional differences within this. In different parts of Scotland, there's greater levels of conflict in terms of development, and in the region that I live, there is less objection and conflict with aquaculture. In terms of whether it's working or not, as a regional marine plan, we're not statutory consultees for aquaculture development. It is a difference compared to other forms of marine licensing. We're a statutory consultee for everything that requires a marine license, but not for aquaculture. So we're not directly involved in providing response unless it falls within the pre-application criteria, in which case we do become a statutory consultee. So it is a difference, or maybe an oversight in that process.
Okay. Mark, can I ask you what your views of the four-stage process?
Well, I think our experience is probably a bit... We're both ends of the poles, to be honest. So we've been involved recently in a pilot program for coordinating pre-application discussions between ourselves and CEPA, really reflecting CEPA's sort of primary role in regulation now, but the planning authorities still being obviously important through the planning application process. So that's been quite detailed. It's made some good progress. I think it's regarded so far as a success and an improvement. But I just reflecting back on what Rachel has said, in terms of marine planning, so in terms of strategic planning, if you regard the pre-apps as very much a sort of tactical type approach, the marine planning is something that we haven't made huge progress on at all. We don't treat the marine environment, our patch of it in Ireland, in quite the same way as we do the terrestrial. I think it would be fair to say.
Ronan, as Crown Estate is part of the consenting group, do you believe you had a sufficient mandate to tackle the challenges that we've just touched on?
So I think when I reflect on the vieries under which Crown Estate Scotland operates and our remit to maintain and seek to enhance the value of the Scottish Crown Estate, and in doing so to advance sustainable development, our contribution in the process as a whole is very much to bookend it at the beginning to provide an option, and at the end, when others have exercised their expertise in matters such as regulation, consenting and spatial planning, to rely on that information and evidence to inform our decision in stepping into a lease. So our perspective is shaped by that context, and I would therefore say I think that our contribution has not been fettered, and we continue to contribute and support the attempts and the efforts to have a more effective and efficient process from start to finish.
Okay, thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Both the Griggs Review and the Rural Economy Committee inquiry recommended that Marine Scotland should act as the overarching body with regard to consenting. Is that something that is being considered? And if so, is it something that you would think would be beneficial?
Yeah, I mean, what has actually happened, of course, I said before, is actually SEPA have probably now become the main regulator. And that's I think, because regulation is quite a nitty-gritty, detailed process. So they were obviously well positioned to take on that sort of work, perhaps more so than Marine Scotland. But having said that, the Sea Life Framework, for example, was very much a joint project between Marine Scotland, as a scientific body, as it were, and SEPA. I think there's a possible role Marine Scotland might possibly be able to take regulation forward in a way that focused down onto one regulator, but please don't ask me how that would come about in a practical sense, because I think what we've realised over the years is that the remit for planning, the remit for SEPA, the remit from Marine Scotland as well, with its various branches, FHI for example, is quite varied, quite eclectic. It's difficult to bind that all together into one discipline, I think.
Okay.
Committee, I would say, as is the case with most forms of change or development, there's benefits and disbenefits. And the concept of a lead agency or actor has value and merit. But there are a variety, based on my understanding of the process that currently exists, of skills and expertise residing in different localities. And for example, the role of Mark and his team would allow for that local community voice to really come through in the process. So whatever approach is ultimately settled upon, we would need to be cautious of not losing facets or attributes that currently add value.
So would you agree that SEPA are best placed rather than Marine Scotland?
I'm not sure that I could give a categorical answer to that here and now.
Okay. And Rachel?
In terms of the roles of the different regulators, the and consenting authorities, obviously Currently, you need planning permission from a local authority, such as an island council or Shetland Islands Council. And planning does sit under a very different legal framework to a marine licence. And as was highlighted by Highland Council, those differences would result in differences in how we manage. So pre-application consultation is very embedded, for instance, within the planning process, and certainly in my area is well utilised by aquaculture developers of all sizes. That process isn't as might be more challenging to deliver by Marine Scotland in a more remote setting, and isn't actually so well embedded in the marine, or isn't legally embedded in the marine licensing process, and as well as monitoring for compliance in terms of whether the site remains well lit or whether it is in the place that was consented. That monitoring role isn't undertaken by Marine Scotland, where it is by a local authority. So if we were speaking of moving from the planning side over to a marine license side, there would be differences within that. Some of those might be positive, but there would also potentially be some negatives of that too.
So do you feel that things are okay as they are, with SEPA apparently taking a lead, or do you believe it should be placed with local authorities? Is that the most important part of the consenting process?
I think the SEPA and councils, or local authorities, sorry, lead on different parts of the consenting process, and both are important because SEPA are the competent authority to look at biological impacts, but they do not have the same level of remit to look at community, like impact communities or other users in the same way. So it might be very challenging to move something like aquaculture to a single consenting process.
Okay, so we have more to gain by the system we have in place at the moment rather than trying to streamline further. We would lose elements if we streamline further.
Just to follow up on that, I was saying, so the argument about this has often jumped between should there be a single entity, sort of a single consenting body and possibly a single consent to aquaculture, or whether there just needs to be better coordination between the different disciplines that Rachel has been highlighting. I think the latter is probably where we are now. There's room for better coordination. That's what the recent pre-app pilot project was about. How can we achieve a higher level of coordination between those different regulators without losing the nature or the essence of what they do, why the regulation is there, and in the body, in the hands of the body that it's in.
Okay, Rachel, would you agree with that?
Yes, I think as Mark's framed it, yes, exactly, that the stronger coordination is perhaps necessary rather than the giving to a single body, as each body brings something quite different to the licensing consenting process.
Ariane Burgess.
You know, just picking up on that, Mark and also Rachel, you both mentioned the stronger coordination. So what kinds of things have you seen change, or do you think need to change in terms of improving that coordination?
Yes, good question. So the pre-app project sort of identified quite a lot of areas. It was a more complicated project than I think one would have imagined at the outset in terms of achieving a coordination. I think there's an advantage to the processes happening in parallel, the regulatory structures happening in parallel. There are plenty of arguments against that as well, where it's quite difficult actually for operators to move through the system in a parallel form. But I think there's probably the biggest outcome from effective coordination would be to allow that to happen, where the planning, the car licence, the marine licence processes would be more in parallel than they are at the moment. And then the discussion of overlapping issues would be discussed at the right point, the most effective point, of course, which doesn't always happen at the moment.
Okay, thanks. Rachel, have you got anything to add to that?
Not specifically, no, other than to note that in a Shetland context, the local authority has established working groups between interested parties, so between aquaculture and fisheries, for instance, to improve that coordination. They have regular meetings now between the sectors, which is a positive development.
Thanks.
Before we move on to this from this section, just one final question to Mark and Rachel. You know, the recommendations were made by the REC committee back in 2018. And we've now got the Scottish Government and its programme for government saying improving one of their objectives to improve the consenting process. That suggests that the pace of change just hasn't been good enough, given we want to see, or the government we want to see an increase in the economic impact that fish farms have. Have we failed over the last 8 years to actually deliver the recommendations of the committee?
It is slow, yes. It's also relatively complicated. I think the introduction, SEPA's work on the framework for their wild fish interactions, there was a lot of science went on in the background for that, and in fact it built on science that had already been going on. So arguably, you could argue that when we got to the framework being introduced, there could well have been nearly 8 years worth of work behind that, not necessarily initiated immediately on the back of the committee's recommendations, but it was there anyway. I think these things are slow, and I think they can be criticised as such. But I have to say, if you bring a large organisation like SEPA with several local authorities, separate local authorities, and try and reform a system and bring marine directorate, and it's quite complicated structure in on top of that, bureaucratically it's quite difficult, and that's perhaps as reflects on that multi-regulatory issue that it's difficult to reform as well as necessarily work with.
Okay, Rachel, any comments on the pace of change?
I think from 2018, we obviously have been through a challenging time, public bodies have through a challenging time, and consenting processes are slow as well. So a start for finish from a consent might take several years in of itself. So whilst it does seem to be quite a long period of time, particularly for those who are seeking change, to implement any change and have statutory consultation times within that will take a number of years. So to see wholesale change, it probably isn't, but it is a long period of time, obviously, but it isn't maybe unsurprising.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to our next theme on strategic spatial planning, and a question from Rachel Hamilton.
Good morning, panel. Do you believe that the spatial planning has progressed since 2018? And what opportunities do you believe there could be to incorporate aquaculture into the progress of spatial planning as we move forward with the new National Marine Plan? I'm going to start with Ronan, if I may.
Thank you. My overarching sense is that across all forms of usage, not just aquaculture, it's fair to say that I have definitely observed advancements and developments with regards to spatial planning, particularly so in relation to the non-aquaculture aspects. And I would cite, for example, the work that we have progressed in the Marine Data Exchange, which seeks to build transparency and more information and using of technology to ensure that spatial planning is supported and informed. I think there remains opportunity, and I think it is about people and technology and data and systems being used in effective and efficient ways to enable decision making and forward-looking decision making, and ultimately to to utilise an incredibly valuable resource in the most effective and efficient way to benefit society and the economy, and of course to ensure that we do so in an environmentally considered fashion.
Something that you would like to see an emphasis on in terms of the balance between socioeconomic benefit and other benefits in the climate, so you know, the biodiversity and the climate change goals that the government are hoping to achieve through the National Marine Plan?
Without doubt, and it's more than wish, from the perspective of Crown Estate Scotland, we are a creature of statute, and our statute requires us to pursue an economic agenda, but at the same time balance the tension constructively with our obligations to advance sustainable development in the broadest sense. That's social and economic and environmental. And we definitely welcome any innovations or advances that aid us in that agenda.
Mark, you talked, I think it was you, Mark, that talked about the kind of bureaucracy around some of the statutory delivery. I am right in saying that, aren't I? It's a bit burdensome. I'm not sure if you use that word, but
yes.
I just wondered...
Well, coordination is burdensome.
Does that translate as well to the role that the Marine Directorate will play? I mean, do you have any concerns about sort of how... Ronan just talked there about how we can use technology and data to improve biodiversity, climate change and socioeconomic benefits. Do you have concern around how... Could you see opportunity in the next National Marine Plan? Were there, you know, have we progressed from 2018?
I think there has been slow progress, or at least slow movement in a certain direction. I think that direction is, I would argue, it's a personal view, overdue. So aquaculture moved into the planning remit in 2007. We have yet, certainly in Highland, I think probably my colleagues and other aquaculture authorities would say the same, we've yet to treat the marine environment, our portion of it that falls within our control, in the same way as we do our terrestrial areas. We don't include them in our local plans in quite the same way. We don't do constraints, cross-checking, identification of better or less attractive areas for certain forms of development. We don't incorporate leases from Crown Estates, you know, into a mapping system and so forth. And I do feel that that is overdue. I think it would be helpful. You mentioned bureaucracy. It's added bureaucracy, of course. It's another plan to take into account. But I think as a local response to National Marine Plan, it would be, from a planner's perspective, the direction in which we should be going. Mm-hmm. And okay. It hasn't happened.
Thank you. Moving to Rachel, if I may, convener. The Marine Conservation Society told the committee that the regional marine plans in the Clyde and Shetland have been delayed for years. What effect is there from the lack of marine planning that is... could be potentially having on those areas?
I think there's two parts to that. Is that our plan in Shetland went out for consultation at the end of 2019, and we hope it will be formally adopted this year, although the Shetland Islands Council now use it as a material consideration in consenting. The implementation phase of marine planning is where it's most likely to be effective rather than in the plan writing itself, and where the delays have ultimately meant that we haven't moved to the implementation phase. And within that, I would see a wealth of opportunity to try and reduce conflicts rather than in the plan making stage, because any plan is only as good as it is being used. So we're very much looking forward to, in Shetland, moving to that implementation phase to be able to support both developers and communities to ensure that the marine environment is used in the most sustainable manner, and to provide further information and support to do that, which has been not been possible at the moment in the way that we would have liked.
Okay. Can I also ask what you believe are the main issues with the current marine spatial strategy, and how do you think that these issues affect salmon farming in Scotland?
I think with any, so in for aquaculture, generally in Scotland, one of the challenges compared to, say England, is that we have an incredibly extensive sea area, but it has an awful lot of different considerations to take into account, both our rich fishing history, wide biodiversity. But within that space, there's still a... despite those constraints, there's still a lot of opportunity for development and for things like renewable energy and for aquaculture, as they both increasingly occur in the offshore environment rather than inshore. Being able to provide meaningful guidance that doesn't get out of date rapidly as technology changes is always going to be a challenge. So for the renewable sector, that has proven to be a challenge as we're now looking at floating offshore wind versus static fixed wind turbines. And in aquaculture, the advancement to offshore aquaculture could mean that if we go for a highly zoned approach that we only review on a five-year cycle, that advice might not be as appropriate as initially perceived. Another challenge can be when we use a constraint mapping approach is that those constraints can be mitigated against. So a very strongly zoned approach might not necessarily identify the most appropriate areas as those technological and understanding technological improvements and advancements are made. So in Shetland, we have never adopted a strongly zoned approach for that reason, so that we can try and be a more adaptive and responsive to change. We'd rather try to ensure that we're providing as much data on socioeconomic and environmental considerations as possible, and providing a policy framework to guide development to reflect the local context, rather than going for a highly zoned and spatially managed approach. But for other areas that might be a more appropriate option. It's just in many parts of Scotland, we do have this extensive area rather than intensive activity like you might see around England, for instance.
I've just got a quick follow-up point, Convener. So you're saying, in a way, you might be agreeing with John Goodland, who is the chair of the SIWG, who actually said that it would be easier for the consenting regime to be attuned to being flexible.
Yes.
So allowing farms to move offshore away from the mouth of the river. But does that mean then that currently the regional marine plans, are they flexible enough, and how do they fit in with the national marine plan?
So a regional plan will go out to 12 miles, so it would, regardless of whether it's within a loch or offshore, it would still be within the remit of a marine plan. And the regional marine plans don't need or have to take a zoning approach, nor does the national marine plan. I think one-size-fits-all approach to management across Scotland is unrealistic, because it is very diverse. We'll see lochs on the west coast of Scotland. The community structures are very different to, say, the Western Isles, Orkney and Shetland. So the marine regions having freedom to develop a locally appropriate response is important within that, rather than having one approach for the whole of Scotland.
Does that ring true with you as well, Mark, in terms of what Rachel's just said about the flexibility?
It makes a lot of sense, and it's a reminder to planners as well that in pursuing a sort of local plan, we have recognised they take a long time to come into force. They're not going to be renewed in a rapid timescale. And Rachel makes a very good point. Technological change in aquaculture is something that we're having to come to terms with all the time. And it can change the way in which the aquaculture interacts with constraints. So I hear exactly what Roche was saying. You don't want a rigid plan. It does have to be a flexible plan, but one I think that can still assist the industry, the public, planners themselves, in assessing where might be best for that new technology to be located, because we do have now the possibility of offshore aquaculture going further offshore. Or we have the possibility of contained aquaculture, which might be more suitable in inland situations. We need to be aware of both of those and plan accordingly.
Okay, thanks.
Peter Swishart.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. My question's around the siting of salmon farms and the policy outcome in NPF 4 that states new aquaculture development is in locations that reflect industry needs and considers environmental impacts. Do you think that's being delivered? Could I start with Mark?
Yes, I hope so, because that's what I'm paid for. It is balancing those two things, and it is quite difficult. With planning now, of course, we're now in a situation where we take put a great deal of weight on the responses from consultees. So our main remit now is going to be visual impact. Although I should add, noise is coming in as an increasing constraint that we'd never appreciated previously, but that's also an issue where farms are close to dwellings. But the work of SEPA and other regulators is something that and advice from Nature Scott and so forth are absolutely critical considerations for us, and we have to take a weighted decision on the basis of that, and it isn't easy. I don't envy our members who often have to take these decisions, but I think by and large we get it right. It's a difficult environment, though, I would say, I don't probably have to say this in this particular building, but where there is a requirement for politicians to take decisions, an industry which has quite a difficult public relations situation at the present time, as I think would be fair to say the aquaculture industry does, makes for quite a difficult environment to take carefully weighted decisions on the basis of scientific constraints, etc., etc. So, it's not easy. I hope we get it. Hope we get it right most of the time.
Thank you. The marine environment is uniquely a public space, and all of our regulators are charged with, for start, a presumption in favour of development. So any constraints must be, whilst taking the precautionary approach, still must consider that we the right to develop within a space. And within that, there will always be winners and losers. Most of the marine environment is appreciated or valued by someone, whether that's fishing or for scenic qualities. So it will always be a challenge for anyone to give a consent where there'll be nobody impacted. And that is also true of building a new house or a new housing development. There will always be people that preferred the status quo. But that isn't a reason not to consent either, and that's the weight of those considerations is the role of the regulator or the planning authority. I have previously reviewed the decisions made by planning authorities, and for the most part, there will always be areas where there is contention between developers and communities or other users. But I think it would be difficult to, everyone will have a different view of whether that, that where that balance is being met between meeting industry needs and meeting other user needs. So therefore may be impossible to judge because everyone has a different view on whether that is correct or not, depending on whether they are an impacted or benefited person or industry.
Thanks, Rachel. And Ronan?
Thank you. I mean, I agree with what has been said, and I think in terms of the question posed and the role of Crown Estate Scotland, I mean, we seek to draw from and rely upon the expert input and contributions from planning and from SEPA and from others with regards to siting. But at a more kind of conceptual level, we recognise the difficulties. Equally, given our vires, we are keen to ensure that there is a sustainable balance achieved between community perspective and important industry for Scotland, ensuring that there is access to use these resources for greater good and national benefit. And we recognise that that is challenging.
I should ask Ronan a slightly different question in terms of Crown Estate Scotland and the income that is derived from salmon farms.
Yes.
Yeah. Can you give an indication of what that is?
Pricing arrangements have been reviewed since 2022, and we derive an income which is a function of production and market price. And since inception, since devolution 2017, up until the end of financial year 2022, circa 50 million has been derived as rents. And of course, under the arrangement, all of those monies are returned to Scottish Consolidated Fund, and then they are passed back through local government for use in the communities.
Thanks, that's help.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks very much. Just before I go on to my main question, I was curious, Mark, you mentioned that noise is becoming a consideration increasingly, but I wondered also about smell. I've been getting quite a bit of correspondence around the smell of fish farms.
Yes. And I don't know whether it's a product of the change in aquaculture activities, both of these factors, or whether it's an increase in sensitivity to the activity itself, to the existence of the fish farms. It's quite difficult to tell. There are more whale boats operating for probably longer periods of time around fish farms. That may explain the noise issue. The smell issue, actually, there's not a huge amount of evidence to identify where the smells are coming from. In my experience, we've had a couple of cases. I don't think fish farms are inherently smelly, put it that way. Obviously, there may well be instances where problems occur. But people, of course, are very sensitive to environmental impacts these days and will quickly get onto their local authority if an incident occurs.
And that's something that you would also take into consideration?
Yes. I mean, residential immunity, of course, is right at the heart of what we do from a planning point of view. So I mentioned it as raised my eyebrows to it because when I started off in aquaculture, it was very rarely raised. Now it is much more frequently raised and represents a genuine issue for us. And it's a sighting issue, of course, because noise and smell both diminish over distance. So the further you are away from residential properties, the better, arguably, as a constraint. But, of course, that does dictate some difficult sighting questions.
Thanks for that. Yeah, I think feed barges also seem to be a noise issue increasingly with the tubes, with the pellets moving through them, along with well boats.
Yeah, there's always some inherent noise with the farm, diesel generators and so forth. Yes, yeah, so sometimes the feed moving through pipes can be noisy. Although, you know, it depends on the design of the feed barge, of course, because a lot of that activity can take place below deck. and in acoustically sandwiched environments. It's often perhaps a question of maintenance and sometimes some odd atmospheric conditions and so forth can make it worse at some time than others. Noise travels over water in a very, very different way to overland, of course.
Okay, thanks very much for that. So you mentioned earlier NatureScot, and I'd be interested to get a sense from you if you, as a Tyneside Council Planning Authority, have a sense that you've got sufficient access to sufficient guidance on how proposed sites or expansions might interact with priority marine features and marine protected areas. And are you getting a sense that you've got enough robust advice on this from NatureScot? And do you think NatureScot has a strong enough role in this planning process? And I'll just say, Rachel, I'll come to you on this as well. I know you're not an authority, but I'd love to get your opinion on that.
I think in terms of the advice we get from NatureScot, we place a great deal of weight on it. So yes, we trust them, we respect them in terms of their advice, and do in the marine environment as we do in the terrestrial environment. One important thing, of course, for NatureScot is that their remit is very much looking at the national picture. So they're very focused upon national level impacts. I think sometimes in aquaculture we come across most things most of the time. Priority marine features are a feature of most fish farm applications. The advice that NatureScot helps us with is to identify the actual scale of that. So sometimes a priority marine feature can cover a vast area of seabed, and obviously the fish farm affects a very small area of the seabed. But in order to make that argument to the public and to members, we obviously would need the advice from NatureScot of that type, and we get it. And it's, obviously they help us also with our habitats regulations appraisals that we're required to do. So, I'm more than satisfied with the work that comes back from NatureScot. I don't think we could do our work without it.
Great, thanks. Just before I go on to Rachel, I just want to clarify something, because you use the term aquaculture quite a bit, but I think you're using it interchangeably with salmon farms, because we're focusing on salmon farms, but aquaculture covers seaweed and shellfish farming as well.
Absolutely, yes. Yes, sorry. Planners obviously do tend to look at it, because that's the bit of aquaculture that falls very much within our remit. But shellfish also, they just present a very different... Usually a very different set of constraints and issues for us.
Okay, thanks for that. Rachel, what are your thoughts on getting sufficient guidance for the impact on proposed sites and expansions and how they interact with priority marine features and marine protected areas?
I think one of the challenges in this space is understanding the extent, as Mark was raising, about priority marine features. The list that was developed by NatureScot, which until then there had never been such comprehensive and clear guidance on what we wish to prioritise as a nation, but it incorporates habitats like mull, which are effectively a non-renewable resource, to species like cod, which whilst I understand there's clear reasons for them being on the list, they are not rare in of themselves. So when any developer, be it renewables or aquaculture, undertakes a baseline survey, it's not unlikely that they might come across some of these priority marine features within a survey, because some of these species are quite ubiquitous around our coast. And the challenge for any decision is to weigh up the individual and cumulative impact on these habitats or species, and whether it's going to affect us respect to habitat, sorry, our species at a national or local scale. And that is where NatureScot are tasked with providing advice on national scale impacts, not on local scale impacts. And there might be some nuance within that in certain localities. For instance, in Shetland, we only have one remaining seagrass bed, which isn't particularly extensive, but it is locally protected because at a local level, it is rare. The other side of that is in Shetland that we have extensive horse mussel beds all around our coast, well, horse mussels and patches of horse mussel beds. And that poses a challenge in determining whether or not a relatively, even for a big aquaculture development, the scale of impact relative to the distribution of a species might be not be regarded as significant. So NatureScot provide a steer on national issues and whether it's going to affect the national PMF at the national level, but they do not have a remit of deciding at that local level, so that falls on the planning authority or the consenting authority to make that decision.
Do you think there's something missing there then? If NatureScot's looking at national and then you use the term falls on the local authority to make that decision, is there something else that's needed, or are you satisfied with the local authority taking that decision in that nuanced way?
There would be obviously in the past, NatureScot or SNH has proceeded, it would have provided more local advice, and now it provides, its remit is to provide national advice. And I imagine there'll be variability within Scotland as to the effectiveness of that change. Obviously, to provide advice at a local level, you need somebody who has the diversity of experience to provide that advice. Whereas NatureScot is an organisation with a vast array of expertise. However, that I do not mean to say that it is not within the planning authority, local authority's capability to provide that advice. It is just simply that it is different than how it operated probably pre-2010, where NatureScot provided both a national and a local steer.
Do you know why that change was made? Why SNH moved away from giving the local steer?
Mark might be better placed on that, but I believe they were directed to by ministers, I think, in terms of ensuring that each authority commented on its area, specific area, and it is part of that streamlining process to avoid duplication of public bodies' efforts, is my recollection. But I'm happy to be corrected.
Mark, you've been...
Yes, I don't know if I actually know the answer to that. It's always been my assumption that it provided a very clear cut. You know, if you're having an impact upon a national level, mm-hmm. your local impact is impacted at a national level, that's probably unacceptable development. So that's fairly clear cut. I would say on a practical note that we do get... still get local advice or advice at a local level from NatureScot. Planners are quite good at pushing for advice on things they don't understand, because we don't like to put our names to reports that contain incorrect information. So it's not that the portcullis came down and there was no question of any interaction at the local level. And sometimes I think to understand a national impact, or whether or not there is a national impact, you do actually need to understand quite a lot about the local impact. So that information is still there. It's not quite as black and white,
right, okay,
as it appeared.
Great, that's very helpful. Ronan, I'm not going to ask you because...
Thanks. I'm just very conscious of time. We've got about 30 minutes and we've still got quite a number of questions. We're going to move on to our third theme, which revolves around sighting near migratory routes. Question from Emma Harper.
Good morning to you, and thanks for being here. So pick up what Rachel said about precautionary principle, and one of the recommendations from the REC committee paper was that a precautionary principle is applied in terms of planning where to site fish farms, and assuming that means that reasonable grounds for concern of siting a farm if it was going to cause harm to migrating fish. So because Rachel mentioned it, I will come to Rachel first. Is a precautionary principle approach currently being applied to planning decisions in relation to siting farms close to migratory routes? And if so, how does that work in practice?
In Shetland, where I am based, we do not have large migratory rivers, so I don't think I'm the best person to answer this question, so I might defer to my colleagues in the Highlands, where they do have this as a issue.
Okay.
Right. Okay. Can I say something quickly about the precautionary principle when it comes to aquaculture? Because I think sometimes it's important to put this in context. We do need to remember that at the national level, the precautionary principle has been applied, and that is the one that says there will not be any aquaculture on the north and east coasts of Scotland, where the largest stocks of migratory fish exist. So I think sometimes that seems to be forgotten, but that is very much a precautionary principle approach at national level. There aren't many presumptions against forms of development in particular locations in Scottish planning. That's one of them, and it's one of a very small number. As far as its application to specifically to a particular farm and migratory fish, I think the framework, the CEPA's framework, has moved that on a great deal. So that's been able to put a modelled assessment of the likely outputs of sea lice from a fish farm, and match that against what knowledge we have so far about migratory routes and sources. It's not just migratory routes either. There's also issues of fish associated with SACs, for example, special areas of conservation, which may be a very specific geographical identification. But I think that has made a large difference. I've got a couple of applications with me at the moment where CEPA have been able to say that they don't expect any significant impact upon migratory fish, and that's purely a question of geography. They're able to make that assessment. That's something we were not able to do. That's not something they were able to come back to us with an answer on, or indeed Nature Scott in years gone by. With that degree of accuracy and scientific background, so that's quite a big change. I would say that is quite a precautionary approach. I think CEPA would, I'm sure you've spoken to CEPA and they'll tell you how they go about their work, but it is on the basis of quite a precautionary approach to risk. So at the moment, I think we would say that we're in a much better position than we were certainly the last time I spoke to the committee on this subject.
Just to come to my second question then, you mentioned, Mark, special areas of conservation. And I'm thinking about enhancing and conserving biodiversity. What legal duties do local authorities and the Crown Estate have when making decisions about aquaculture consents? And how are these embedded into the decision-making as we move forward for consenting?
Okay, well, where we're dealing with a special area of conservation, used to be termed the European sites, there is a legal obligation as through the Habitats regulations. So we have to first take advice as to whether there might be a significant effect, and that's a precautionary principle because it's a very low threshold, very low hurdle. If it is considered that there's likely to be a significant effect, we then have to engage in an appropriate assessment, which is a much more detailed, scientifically based assessment. That's one of the areas in which we get a great deal of assistance from Nature Scott at a very practical level. And that's to assess whether or not there'll be an adverse effect on site integrity, so harm caused to the SAC. So that's an area I think most people would agree that works very effectively in terms of those limited numbers of SACs, which from our point of view might be a salmon spawning river, might be a river containing freshwater per mussel, that sort of thing.
Again, from the perspective of Crown Estate Scotland, given that our role within the end-to-end consenting process is very much that of landlord and providing an option and then entering into a lease agreement, our obligations stem from the primary legislation again, and it is this obligation to maintain and seek to enhance the value of the estate, and that actually manifests in the form of an obligation to seek market value for the commercial arrangement. As mentioned earlier, our contribution and role means that we very much seek to draw from and rely upon the expert advice in terms of siting and broader consenting considerations from the likes of SEPA, the planning authorities, and indeed the I'm drawing on Nature Scot. We do, however, also have an obligation to seek to advance sustainable development, and we do that and we exercise that as best we can through our leasing provisions and covenants, and that is reflected in the fact that in recent years we have sought to innovate and to bring forward sustainability reporting obligations for our tenants, and we believe that that is a positive contribution in terms of that aspect of our obligations.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Just before we move on, the committee recently heard that there was evidence that sites are still being consented close to migratory routes, despite the policies in MPF4, and that district salmon fishery boards' views were not given enough weight. Mark, on your experience, do you recognise those comments or concerns?
Well, it's relatively early days with the threshold, certainly not my personal experience. I suppose we have to be a little bit careful about having moved this on to a scientific footing, that we then apply a parameter like just distance, proximity. I don't think that oversimplifies what SEPA have been working at, which is much more to do with the distribution of planktonic sea lice within areas. So it's not inconceivable that a plume of sea lice emanating from a farm might actually move in the opposite direction to the migratory fish. So actually the level of interaction, despite the spatial distance being relatively low, the level of interaction would be low as well. I don't have any personal experience of having to deal with that one. The most recent that I had was simply a question where there was a significant distance, to go back to distance, between these particular farms and the migratory fish route. But it still needed to take into account the direction that the movement of sea lice would take through water.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to our next theme, which is enforcement, and a question from Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm picking up on a number of the recommendations that were made by the REC committee, and recommendation 9 says the committee considers the current level of mortalities to be too high in general across the sector, and it's very concerned to note the extremely high mortality rates at particular sites, and it's of the view that no expansion should be permitted at sites which report high or significantly increased levels of mortalities until these are addressed to the satisfaction of the appropriate regulatory bodies. And I think we've been hearing throughout these evidence sessions of high numbers of mortality, and I think we've got one here that's a salmon farm in Loch Seaforth in the Western Isles, where more than 1 million fish died in a production cycle in 2023, and the level of suffering carried on for 6 months without any consequences. And I just wonder what you think about that. I mean, we throughout the evidence sessions we've been taking, it seems to be that these high level of mortalities are increasing, possibly due to climate change, maybe other reasons. But it seems that nobody in the whole kind of process seems to be responsible for the mortalities. We can't quite get to the bottom of that. Do you have any thoughts on that and what we can be doing about it?
So, yes, that's quite a difficult area. It's one that we wouldn't normally consider a material consideration in planning, and there's a very good reason for that, because obviously we take the assumption that the operator also wishes to see mortalities at a minimum level, preferably zero, for their own sort of economic reasons and cost reasons. I think there are undoubtedly environmental factors emerging or have emerged recently in terms of gill disease on fish, which is another factor. In fact, it's probably taken over by a long measure beyond the health effects of sea lice. But it's not something, I think it would be quite difficult for planning to take it into account, although we were talking about spatial mapping. I suppose if we there need to be a lot of science done, I don't know if that is being done at the moment, to identify perhaps those areas of the coastline that are more prone to the environmental factors that lead to gill disease, and therefore you assume you wouldn't put a farm there. I have to say, though, it's the sort of work that first and foremost you'd expect the operators to have done, and I think they do. So it is difficult to see how that can be factored in. I don't know enough about the ongoing science to identify that. Climate change issues would be a concern because it could affect a large part of the production area, of course.
So when you're consenting on a farm, you don't have any data on, like you were saying, maybe we need to be looking at the spatial mapping. So at the moment, you don't have any data on the kind of tendency. And I guess what Rachel was saying earlier is that it's quite a fluid, changing picture when we're dealing with marine space.
Yes, I think it would be very difficult to map it, very difficult to take it into account, not least because the industry has actually developed techniques to overcome these problems to a degree and counter the issues. We don't need to take that into account as well, as we have done with sea lice. It's probably not something that's going to come into the planning remit, I think. And I'm not sure. I think probably your question was, well, which regulator would it fall with, and that is also a difficult question.
Yeah, well, I mean, in a way, the REC committee made these recommendations and are saying we need to do something about it. And certainly, it seems to me recommendation number 9, we're not really getting anywhere with it. But Ronan, I wonder, you talked earlier about CES having our sustainability reporting obligations, and I just wonder if maybe, how does Crown Estate Scotland, what do they think about the fact that they are a landlord, a seabed lord to companies that are have a business that is bringing about a high level of mortality and also suffering?
So I think the first thing is that I believe all participants in the industry and all actors in the system of local and central government are firmly of the view that mortality does not benefit anybody. It is something that we would all collectively wish to see reduced. I think on a point that was made earlier, I must admit that the data that I have seen does suggest that it's kind of static or holding steady and fluctuating rather than worsening, but I may be looking at different data sets. I think that the best way to drive change is to support change. And my inclination is that the industry is already incentivized economically to want to improve mortality rates. And I think the question is how can that be supported or aided? And it'll ultimately be through innovation. And it will be through the application of progressive research. Because it's a dynamic situation, operating in a dynamic environment. And so I would suggest that we need to see greater investment and collaboration across all participants, because it's a win-win-win to address mortality and to drive it down. It is regrettably a feature of all forms of farming. Obviously, it's not appropriate to draw comparisons between terrestrial farming and marine farming, or indeed across different species, but it's a problem that is common to all forms of farming. And how does Crown Estate Scotland view this? I mean,
point there, because I think if we had, you know, a million chickens or pigs dying on land, we would there would be an outcry.
Yes.
So I think we need to be really looking at this.
No, I agree, and that's why I'm saying I think comparison between different sectors is not necessarily logical. But in terms of Crown Estate Scotland, it is something that we would like to work with others on addressing and improving. We do have provisions within our sustainability reporting to evolve that over time. I think that provides an opportunity, but I do ultimately believe that the way forward is investment in collaborative research.
Okay. I mean, my sense is that the industry kind of sees a high level of mortality as actually just the price of doing business. That seems to be what we're hearing throughout these evidence sessions. I'll just come on to Rachel, and any thoughts on from your perspective around what we could do to address the mortality issue, or how do we support the industry to improve there?
I think touching on your original point about whether there should be a standard threshold, I think would advise a level of caution, because some mass mortality events, say driven by a algae or jellyfish bloom, might occur at one locality once and never again for 20 years, which I have observed in Shetland, that there's been one particular species of jellyfish that bloomed and caused mass mortality, and there's never been seen to do this again in that that species never to bloom again and never to impact those localities again. So whilst the one-off mortality was at those localities very high, it's preventing aquaculture at that site in future years wouldn't have been necessary. So I think that might be some of the challenge on posing a relatively arbitrary trigger to prevent restocking. Some of these challenges, like those posed by Hydrinodusae, which is a type of jellyfish, can cause ongoing mortality for months beyond the initial bloom. I can't comment on the example that you gave, but that can be a continued problem within one cycle of fish. So my understanding is the aquaculture industry has invested heavily in this area already, have trained staff to monitor water quality, and I'm sure continued scientific support would, as highlighted by the Crown Estate, would I'm sure be welcomed, but I think they, as already suggested, the industry would be clearly be very motivated to minimise mortalities where possible, and are investing in that where they can.
Okay, thanks very much.
Move on now to a question from Colin Beattie.
That's just a question or two about environmental management plans. At the meeting of this committee on 26th of June 24, Fisheries Management Scotland raised concerns about lack of enforcement of EMPs and the planning conditions designed to limit escapes. Can I ask, and I'll start with you, Rachel, how standard practice are there to have environmental management plans, and what impact are they having?
That isn't within my remit as a strategic marine planner, so I think that would be better directed to Mark.
Right, Mark.
Okay. Well, the environmental management plans were brought in. You're quite right. They tend to be two-parted. They tend to have been dealing with the monitoring of the impact of sea lice, and also included an element about escapes, escape plans. The introduction of the framework from CEPA has probably meant that environmental management plans in their current form are no longer required. So the need to, or the attempt to control sea lice impacts by monitoring wild fish on its own is not likely to be something that planning authorities pursue any longer. It may well be that wild fish monitoring initiated by SEPA to support the framework will still be there, and we're still discussing how the two may cross over. But I think find that generally they are less likely to be used in terms of sea lice. In terms of escapes has always been a difficult area. There is a legal requirement, of course, on operators to report escapes to a Marine Directorate. It was something that planners incorporated into environmental management plans, largely because, just to ensure that a proper planning approach was taken, so that it was in the public domain as to what the operator was doing, in order to ensure that their escapes were kept to a minimum. In my experience, they didn't include a great deal of information about what to do if there was an escape. That was something, again, that was left very much to Marine Directorate. So I think probably you'd have to say that environmental management plans are on their way out as far as in their form of being attached to planning applications. So it might be incorporated within the sort of car licensing procedures by SEPA.
So just to clarify, Highlands Council doesn't enforce any aspect of environmental management plans at this time?
Well, the area of enforcement, so I suppose there's two aspects to that. One was to ensure that the environmental management plan in terms of monitoring was carried out. So we've been active in terms of ensuring that monitoring is carried out, and carried out in an appropriate manner. So we've taken advice on the best techniques for monitoring wild fish and the best locations and so forth on several occasions. In terms of monitoring the outcomes, I don't think we've had a situation where we've identified a fish farm, or there being enough evidence to identify that a fish farm was having an unacceptable, harmful impact upon local wild fish through sea lice emissions. We never got to that point, and I have to say that's probably the weakness of the environmental management plan. It was going to be very difficult to get to that point, I suspect. There's a lot, you know, to develop enough evidence to take the matter to enforcement. And that's where one of the reasons where there was a crying need for SEPA's framework, the scientifically evidenced approach, to come forward.
So just so I completely understand this, environmental management plans still exist, but they are gradually falling into disuse?
Well, they may not. To the extent that they are a mechanism by which wild fish are monitored for sea lice impacts and health, general health, they may still have a swan song, as it were, in supporting the evidence being used by SEPA within the framework. So the framework initially has come in as a modelled approach to risk in terms of sea lice wild fish interactions. But of course, in the background, there's always a need to empirically test a modelling approach. And the work that the EMPs initiated might well provide that that input as well, might provide that model, that empirical assessment of the health of local wild fish.
To be honest, to a layman, it sounds a bit woolly. It sounds as if there's probably something coming down the line which will effectively replace this. It hasn't arrived yet. You don't really know what the full form of that's going to be. But gradually, the environmental management plans are just not being used anymore.
Well, I think a great deal of weight can be placed upon the framework as it exists at the moment. I mean, the science behind the modelling that SEPA are using to identify where there may or may not be interactions between a fish farm and wild fish in a way that would be harmful to populations of wild fish, I think it's pretty robust. And obviously, you know, as I was saying earlier, that's taken things on a good deal further than local authorities were able to do through the information coming from EMPs. Where I would say EMPs have been successful is that they have stimulated a level of work coordination, cooperation between operators and local fisheries boards and river trusts and so forth in terms of how to carry out the monitoring of wild fish and their health, sea lice impacts, in the best possible way. So there have been some positives, but their enforcement was always going to be difficult because it was very rare that you were going to come across information from an assessment and in the field that would be like a smoking gun indicating that a fish farm was having an unacceptable impact upon wild fish. And I don't think anyone has ever delivered data of that nature.
Ronan, can I ask if you've got any input on this?
To be honest, I'm not sure I could add meaningfully to what Mark has already relayed.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Just very conscious of time, just a very, very brief question, and I'm hoping we can get a brief response. When it comes to planning enforcement, are the lines of responsibility clear that who actually is responsible for ensuring the conditions are met? And is there any possibility, if there's not information sharing, that issues could fall between the slats, if you like? Mark?
Oh, gosh. Brief answer. Planning enforcement, if the condition is worded well, then it's quite clear what parameters are needed and we can draw on other bodies in order to work that out. The only thing I would say about planning enforcement is that ultimately, whilst we can serve stop notices and so forth, we'd be wary of doing that unless we had very, very good evidence, because clearly there's issues. It's a commercial operation. There's issues of compensation here. And also the alternative, obviously, is to go to a local court. And to be honest, the local courts are quite busy and tend to be less interested in the sort of actions that local authorities bring forward. So there is an issue there.
So just summing up, it would appear that there is a lack of capacity or the ability to effectively and sufficiently enforce planning conditions?
Well, not generally, but I'd say in terms of these environmental issues there are. One of the advantages of CEPA, of course, is it moved onto a licensing arrangement, which is very, very different from Planning Commission. We grant permanently licences need renewing, and that gives them a very, very strong handle in terms of enforcement.
OK, thank you. We're going to now move on to our final theme on community engagement. Karen Adam.
Can I ask, does the new pilot process reduce opportunities for local and community engagement through the streamlining, or does it reduce timeframes for consenting? Can I come to Mark first, please?
One of the attractive things about the pre-app process for us, theoretically, is that although there are various points at which in the planning process where public consultation is a requirement at the pre-app stage, I should say, before application is made. As you know, obviously, it's a requirement once an application is made. We were aware that CEPA often engage in a public consultation process early on in their own pre-app process. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we were keen to do from local authorities is coordinate the work through the pilot in order to obtain an earlier input from communities. So far, I think the examples that we've had have been a sort of mixed picture about that. We've certainly had one pilot which fell within the major application scale, so the operator was required to carry out a public consultation, part of the PAN requirements. In the other cases, there was less of a community to engage directly. I think we might, in the pilot, still be looking for an application that, perhaps a new farm that sits close to a close to a community. And then I think there is the opportunity to, through the pilot or through the pre-app process, to coordinate CEPA's and planning's work. So arguably that would improve public consultation process. Okay.
Can I ask, Rachel, do you think there are ways that local engagement could be improved to deliver the social contract that's envisioned by the Griggs Review, both during the consenting and throughout the lifetime of the development?
In terms of community and public engagement, I think there's a number of things to consider. There's including people in the process, which makes them feel listened to and valued, which ultimately research suggests that makes people much happier with any outcome that does come through the process. So drawing on that pre-application consultation that might that occurs early, that is often key to ensuring that communities do feel heard and values and people feel heard and valued. In terms of developing a formal social contract, there's a number of challenges within any process, I suppose, in terms of assuming the public wants to be the level of engagement they might want to take. And I guess this is more likely to occur where a development is controversial rather than where it isn't. So the effectiveness of any social contract is going to be more complicated depending on the particular locality and the information detail that might be wanted to be included within that. But in terms of a development going into the future, many of the concerns that might be raised at the pre-application stage, you would hope would have been addressed during the consenting process. So the ongoing issues you would hope would be minimal.
Thank you. Ronan, can I ask, regarding the Crown Estate's leasing role, are there any community engagement or community benefit mechanisms associated with those decisions? And are there calls for a community benefit mechanism?
So it's a good question. I think the first thing is there are already arrangements in place whereby the monies flow back to the communities. And I'm not sure we take full advantage on making that fully transparent and communicating that effectively so that those communities can see very clearly the impact of the commercial arrangements in their locality. In terms of Crown Estate Scotland staff, myself and my colleagues, I mean, we view ourselves very much as serving and supporting the communities where there are assets under management. And we view that as a long, ongoing relationship that's very important. I would say we channel small amounts of monies into initiatives such as our Sustainable Communities Funds, where we support on the ground initiatives to enhance community opportunities. If I was to say what opportunities exist for the future, I would suggest, and it's at the discretion of others, that if more monies were retained by Crown Estate Scotland for reinvestment at a localised level, we could potentially make that impact more meaningful, more immediate and more visible.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Edward Mington.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I'd like to concentrate on two recommendations in the report that we produced in 2018. Recommendation 51, which I'm sure, Mark, you'll know off the top of your head, but just to remind you if you don't. A strategic spatial planning exercise undertaken by the Scottish Government, taking into account all of the affected areas. That was a recommendation. It should be carried out. Has it been carried out? Are you using that in making your planning decisions?
I think that probably refers back to an earlier discussion about whether we apply the same sort of level of
I'm asking if there is a map-based spatial planning exercise carried out by the Scottish Government which says where fish farms should be allowed and where they shouldn't be allowed, which has been produced in conjunction with CEPA. Do you have such a map? And are you using it?
No, there's no such map has been.
Okay, so that's recommendation 51 been ignored then by definition. I want to take you to recommendation 53, which is the relocation of fish farms where it is clear that they are a problem. How many planning applications have the Highland Council considered where relocations of fish farms because they are a problem in their existing site? Have you received an action?
Well, I don't think we've got to the first stage yet because I don't think we've identified where that there are problematic fish farms. But that is another aspect of the framework which might be particularly useful because CEPA might well be able to identify such a thing, in which case we would certainly view relocation. How different relocation is from a application for a new fish farm is another matter because we don't control whether the company wants to close down the existing one, although that might be CEPA's requirement. But we obviously would look at a fresh fish farm in much the same way as we would any other application.
Do you know how depressing that is for me, having sat on the committee in 2018, which made recommendations that poorly sited fish farms should be relocated to take the threat away from their production because of high mortality or wild fish production because they're on existing routes and you're telling me it's not been done 6 years later.
Yeah.
Would you be depressed?
Well, not so much because relocation I don't think was the only issue. I mean, what I've seen since I sat here previously is an industry which has become very much focused on reworking its existing units. We've certainly in Highland, we've actually dealt with a surprisingly low number of new fish farm sites, but we've dealt with a very large number of reworking farm sites in order to make, and most of that is to do with making them more productive, as you say, and more environmentally sustainable. So I think perhaps the relocation is not the only issue.
It certainly isn't the only issue, but it was one that was focused on very heavily by the report.
Mm.
And it was something that the salmon farmers in Scotland said that they would consider and put on the high list of their priorities. I remember them saying that, and we're saying we have nothing. I'll just leave it there, Convener, because I may get more depressed as my questionings continue.
Thank you very much. That concludes our witness session. So I'd like to thank you all for coming today. That's been most helpful. Before our next item is consideration of the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, but I propose we take a 15-minute break. So suspend the meeting for 15 minutes. And we now turn to consideration of Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill at Stage 2. And I welcome to the meeting Christine Graham, the member in charge of the bill, who's supported by officials from the Parliamentary's Non-Governmental Bills Unit and legal teams. And I also welcome Jim Fairley, the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, and his supporting officials from the Scottish Government. So now call Amendment 60 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Rachel Hamilton to move Amendment 60 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener, and I move Amendment 60 in my name. Amendment 60 requires the 2010 Code, which was introduced under the 2006 Act, to include good practice in relation to animal welfare for people to follow when acquiring or transferring a dog to another person. The 2010 Code of Practice for the Welfare of Dogs centred on five areas: the need for a suitable environment, the need for a suitable diet, the need to be able to exhibit normal behavioural patterns, the need to be housed with or apart from other animals, and the need to be protected from suffering, injury and disease. As currently drafted, the bill would create a new and separate code of practice alongside the existing 2006 code. And as noted by the Law Society, this could create a potential risk of overlap or contradiction between the existing code of practice 2006 and that envisaged under the bill. Therefore, my amendment seeks to minimise any potential confusion from the public by incorporating the proposed code into the existing code. An amendment to this effect was suggested when the Dogs Trust told us during committee proceedings that they were really keen, I'm quoting, really keen on there being streamlining so that there is one code of practice if possible. Moreover, the Scottish SPCA also stated during committee proceedings that, and I quote, having multiple documents is not an easy way of proving that somebody has managed to grasp all that knowledge if they are required to look at various sources of information. Further adding, their plea is to keep it simple and update or revise the existing code, because it would be better from a practical point of view to prove whether a person should have had that knowledge as part of an investigation. Moreover, as currently drafted, Section 6 of the bill makes it clear that a breach of the new code would not be an offence in and of itself. Therefore, my amendment would also provide for improved practical enforcement through the existing 2010 code in relation to animal welfare investigations. Moving to amendments 63, 65, 66, 71, 73, 74 and 77 are the relevant consequential amendments for amendment 60 and remove all the sections in the bill which would have created a new separate code. I would like to note that while my favourite option would be for the code of practice to be incorporated into the 2010 code, and to do so, it is necessary to remove sections 1 to 7 in this bill. I appreciate that my amendments may not gain support, and therefore there are several amendments to section 1 to 7 which I will be supporting as they improve the bill. But I look forward to hearing from the Minister with regards to the incorporation into the 2007 code.
Any other members? No. Minister?
Thank you very much, Convener, and I thank Rachel Hamilton for explaining the purpose of her amendments. However, I cannot agree with them. It is the view of the Scottish Government, shared by the committee at stage one, and the view of Christine Graham, that a new standalone, concise and accessible code of practice specifically relating to the acquisition of dogs should be produced after due consultation. The intention would be for the new code to complement the wider advice on keeping dogs in the current Welfare of Dogs Code and future iterations of this, with clear signposting between the codes to minimise any potential confusion. So therefore I do not support the amendments 60, 63, 65, 66, 71, 73, 74 or 77, and I would ask Rachel Hamilton not to press them.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much to Rachel Hamilton. As you know, at the stage one, I took the position that it was important to have a separate, standalone, simple code before you acquire a dog or a puppy. The difference between this and the existing code is The other code, in fact, is when you already have it. So mine's like almost a preemptive strike to make sure you've taken up all these welfare issues and accommodation and so on in advance of even proceeding. So I really, as you know, do not support this. And also, I concern as a sort of ancillary comment, there's 36 pages to that other code. It's pretty cumbersome. And I don't think many people, with respect, will have read it. And if they have, it's after they've got the dog. Whereas I'm looking for something that's maybe one side of A4 in simple language so that it's not complicated. People don't desist because it's so many pages from actually reading it and they have a look at it in advance. And it was written in a very, well, a similar style, but I hope very easy read. Straightforward conversational language. I know that's not in my bill and won't come to that later, but I want it to be in conversational language so people understand in simple terms what they take on. This is to, in the best interests of the dog, the puppy, and indeed the potential owner. So obviously I really don't, I reject that amendment, which of course is a wrecking amendment and would completely take my bill out of the picture.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton, to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 60.
Thank you, Convener. I am disappointed by Jim Fairley, the Minister's comments, and disappointed that the Scottish Government doesn't agree that the Code of Practice should be incorporated into the original Code of Practice. I've got the Code of Practice of Welfare of Dogs here in front of me. It's got a great picture of a little dog on the front, and yes, it is fairly long, as Christine Graham says, it's 28 pages long, but it is comprehensive, and the same issues will arise with regards to the awareness amongst those who are looking to purchase a dog, acquire a dog, and to ensure that they have the highest standards of welfare that they are considering. Within the one page of the Christine Graham says that will be more concise. However, this is all about the welfare of dogs. And I think that it is no surprise to me that Scottish Government want to take a route which doesn't incorporate sensibly into one document the whole process of acquiring and subsequently looking after a dog. I'm incredibly disappointed. I just think it's the onerous route. And once again, the Government are not taking the practical route. I will press.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 60 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment, please raise your hand. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against, 0 abstentions. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I now call Amendment 6 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Minister to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I'm moving amendment in my name. Convener, these amendments concern the scope of the Code of the Practice. Amendment 6 is a minor clarification to avoid any unnecessary confusion about the scope of the Code. The code should apply to all persons in the legal sense, whether the individual, people or legal entities such as companies or partnerships. Including the wording for people in the bill might be taken as restricting the meaning to natural persons only, so it is proposed to remove this to avoid any uncertainty. Amendments 8, 18, 29, 30, 31, 35 and 37 in my name standardise the terminology used in the bill by referring to transferring a dog rather than the mix of terms currently included in the bill. Amendment 17 defines transferring as including selling, giving away, exchanging, bartering or arranging for the long-term loan or long-term fostering of a dog. This is an inclusive definition, so in any other arrangement which would effectively be a transfer of a dog would be caught by the Code of Practice. And again, this is aimed at preventing people from arguing that they are not covered by the code. I move Amendment 6.
Any other members? Oh, Christine Graham.
Yes, I very much welcome these amendments which improve and strengthen the bill.
Thank you. Minister, to wind up.
Nothing further to add, can we?
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I now call Amendment 7 in the name of Christine Graham, grouped with Amendments 9 and 56. Christine Graham to move Amendment 7 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you. Before I get, I move Amendment 7, I speak to other amendments in the group. And as you see, it's to delete, to keep as a pet, and to leave out as pets. That's 7, 8, and 7, 9, and 56. And I reflected after the stage one debate, which made it clear to me that there could be a loophole or some confusion if I try to make some kind of definitive difference between a working dog and a pet. I mean, we all know clearly which are working dogs, that dogs for the blind, police dogs, shepherding dogs, hearing dogs to deaf. That's clear. But there are categories where there could be crossover. And to include all dogs is not to malign or in a way criticise people who employ and acquire working dogs. I know they are very thorough in what they do. But it's this fact that there could be a loophole and that somebody could claim, well, mine's as a working dog when in fact it was a pet. So I think that just makes it easier for everyone. And if there's any dispute, there can't be because it's just a dog. But I really don't consider that in many cases those who acquire working dogs, they do all this anyway. So there's no harm to them. It's not in any way to criticise them because they've got a dog that has to earn its keep, as it were. So they know the breeding, they know where it's come from. I say to the convener, you're a farmer, you know what I'm talking about. And to Mr. Fairley equally and Mr. Mountain, you know what I'm talking about. I think it just makes it simpler if I just say pet dogs and not pets. I hope I've won your hearts with that, Mr. Mountain.
Thank you. Minister.
I am. I do apologise. I am pleased that Christine Graham has brought forward Amendments 7, 9, and 56, which remove the qualification that the code applies when a dog is acquired to keep as a pet. As highlighted by the committee at stage one, that could become a loophole for unscrupulous breeders. So I urge members to support these amendments.
Thank you. Christine Graham to wind up.
I've really nothing further to add. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 9 in the name of Christine Graham, already debated with Amendment 7. Christine Graham to move formally. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I now call Amendment 10 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. And can I point out that if Amendment 62 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 15 due to preemption. Minister to move Amendment 10 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, the Scottish Government is keen to develop the code of practice required by the Bill, and the initial engagement with stakeholders has already begun. Amendment 14 will ensure that any consultation that takes place before the Bill comes into force will count towards the consultation requirement contained in the Bill so that the code can be finalised as soon as possible after that. Amendments 10 to 13 introduce greater flexibility for preparation of the code. Scottish Government's view is that specifying in detail what the code should include is an unusual and unnecessary use of primary legislation. We prefer to develop the contents of the code through consultation with stakeholders. Amendment 10 provides that Scottish ministers must have regard to the matters set out in sections 2 and 3, making the code of practice, and that those matters to a provision that it may do so. It retains the requirement that the code of practice must prescribe the form of a certificate for both the acquirer and supplier of the dog to sign in accordance with Stage 1 report recommendations. Amendments 47 and 48 to Section 5 clarify that the process for developing and consulting on future revisions of the code will be the same as for the initial code. Amendment 55 means the bill will come into force for 2 months after royal assent rather than the day after royal assent as is currently provided. And Amendment 15 will increase the timescale to produce the code of practice from 6 months to 12 months in line with the recommendations in the Stage 1 report. The committee agreed that the requirement for a code to be made within 6 months of royal assent is impractical and, given the value of a consultation to inform a code, unlikely to result in a well-drafted code which is fit for purpose. It will require more than 6 months to allow for consultation, development of the code and obtaining the views on further wording or recommendations from stakeholders. In addition to the content specified in the bill, it is expected additional guidance on other matters relating to the acquiring of a dog, such as the risks associated with imported rescue dogs and extreme conformations due to undesirable breeding practices, could be included in the code following consultation with stakeholders. Amendment 16 will allow for the timescale within which the code of practice must take effect to be amended by way of regulations. This amendment has been proposed in order to avoid the difficulties that sometimes occur where timescales that are fixed in legislation subsequently become unachievable. Without this power, any amendment to the timescale could only be achieved by way of primary legislation. I'd like to assure you that we consider it highly unlikely that it will be necessary to use this power, and we fully expect that the code of practice... Hold on. Yeah.
Why put a timescale of 12 months if you can't achieve it?
We're not saying that we can't achieve it. What we're saying is...
That's what you are. You're saying you can't achieve. You've just said that. You're making it flexible because you think you won't achieve it.
That's not what I said. What I said was, in the event that something happens that we couldn't achieve it, then we want the flexibility to be able to have the 12 months.
What is the government envisaging that will happen?
I've absolutely no idea. COVID. Who would know? There could be any number of reasons why a bill couldn't be concluded within the 12-month period. This allows us the flexibility if something does happen. We fully expect to have it done well within the 12 months or within the 12-month period, but this is a security just to make sure. Okay. Therefore, I would like to assure you that we consider it highly unlikely that it will be necessary to use this power, and we fully expect the code of practice will be developed, consulted on and come into effect well within the 12-month period after royal assent should this bill be passed. However, it is only prudent to be prepared for any unforeseen complications and to avoid having to then consider returning to primary legislation to extend the deadline should this become necessary. Findlay-Carson's Amendments 61 and 62 would require the code to be laid before Parliament for approval and would remove any timescale for preparing the code. The Scottish Government's main reason for the commitment to replace codes of practice made under Section 37 of the 2006 Act with guidance made under Section 38 of the 2006 Act is to provide a quicker, more practical method for drafting, publishing and amending good practice information for the relevant parties. The provision of up-to-date good practice information is important if we are to support owners and keepers in maintaining the welfare of the animals in their care. In the case of dogs and the purchasing of dogs, ensuring that our good practice information is kept up to date is important in keeping up to date with the new legislation or growing trends in this area. Therefore, we would not want this code to be subject to a requirement to lay it before Parliament. And Rhoda Grant's Amendment 72 would mean that a revised code would need to be published, even if the revisions did not materially alter that effect. The Scottish Government is very happy to support this amendment, which would ensure that the public is made aware of any changes to the code, big or small, and I move Amendment 10.
Thank you. I now call Findlay-Carson to speak to Amendment 61 and other amendments in the group. My amendment requires the Code of Practice to be subject to parliamentary scrutiny under the affirmative procedure. Christine Graham has proposed that the Code of Practice under this bill would not be subject to parliamentary scrutiny, but the Delegated Powers Memorandum explains that she took this approach as the scope of the Section 1 and 5 power is narrowed by provisions set out in the face of the bill, and that any other matters included by the Scottish ministers would be informed by their consultation exercise. It concluded, and I quote, that the member considers that the core content of the code will stand the test of time, and it is therefore appropriate to include it in this way, as a substantial element of the code will have been scrutinised by the Parliament during the passage of the bill. However, my amendment is that the code is subject to parliamentary scrutiny under the affirmative procedure. The Rural Affairs Committee in their stage one report referred to Section 37 of the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland 2006 Act, which states that any animal welfare code must be laid before and approved by resolution of the Scottish Parliament before it can come into effect. The Stage 1 report also referred to the report produced by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, in which it concluded that the Code of Practice should be subject to parliamentary scrutiny due to the evidential link between compliance with the Code and the possible commission of an offence. under Section 6 of the Welfare of Dogs Bill. The DPLR committee recommended the Code of Practice should be subject to a parliamentary procedure and set out the arguments for either the affirmative or negative procedure. The argument the committee saw in favour of the affirmative being the evidential link of a failure to follow the Code of Practice to the possible commissioning of offence and the power for ministers to review, to revise the code after consultation. This would align with the code with Code of Practices made under the 2006 Act. So once again, I would ask members to support my amendment, which would mean that the Code of Practice be scrutinised by Parliament under affirmative procedure, as it more closely aligns with the 2006 Act, giving power to ministers to revise after consultation and the evidential link of a failure to follow the Code of Practice and the potential of an offence being committed. Rhoda Grant, to speak to Amendment 72 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Section 6 provides Scottish ministers do not need to publish a revised code of practice if they consider that none of the revisions materially alters the effect of the Code of Practice. My amendment would remove this section from the bill, having the effect that any revised Code of Practice must be published and made available to the public. And I'm grateful for government support to this amendment.
Thank you. Any other members? Rachel Hamilton.
Convener, I've listened to what the Minister has to say. We cannot support amendments 11 and 12. 11 is weaker wording. It means ministers don't have to include provisions giving effect to sections 2 and 4. And amendment 12 means that ministers don't have to include provisions giving effect to section 4. But the main concern I have... Just on Rhoda Grant's Amendment 72, happy to support that, and very happy to support Finlay Carson's Amendments 61 and 62, which seem entirely sensible. But my key opposition is to Amendment 16. As currently drafted, the Code of Practice must be published within 6 months of oral assent, and I welcome that the Minister has accepted the committee's recommendation to increase this to 12 months, to allow sufficient time for an effective consultation. However, Amendment 16, also lodged by the Minister, allows the Scottish Government to change the date by which the Code of Practice must be published, which suggests, as I intervened on the Minister, that the Government suspects that this will likely not be achievable and it will fail to meet the required timescale despite already increasing it to 12 months. I cannot support Amendment 16 because it is wrong for the Scottish Government to create a loophole in this bill to give them an easy way out if they fail to keep to the required timescales. Yes.
I would ask the member why the member would consider that the government would try to put a loophole in this bill. We agree that we want this bill to happen. We all agree that we want this bill to pass. There is no, there is nothing that the government are trying to do here that would stall it or stop it. We have given a quite clear commitment that all things being equal, we will produce this, we'll get this done within the 12-month period, but this is to give us an insurance policy in case anything goes wrong so that we don't have to start again. There is nothing underhand or untoward being done here. This is simply to give us an insurance policy.
Thank you for the intervention, Mr. Fairley. However, I do think that it would be reassuring to get some similar amendments in legislation. This is not something that I have come across during the passage of the legislation that we've been taking forward in this committee. It's just very unusual, and that's why I'm highlighting it. It just appears that the government are expecting to fail, and I think... In terms of what I'm trying to say is that the government should be accepting as to why I'm questioning this, because it is unusual. Thank you.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Convener. Well, the Minister says that the amendments that he's put down, a substantial number of them, offer flexibility. I think they kind of water things down a bit. If I focus, for example, on Amendment 10, what I have is give effect to, in quotes, and that in Amendment 10 is being deleted to subject must have regard to. That's not flexibility to me. That is well, you could call it flexibility, but it gives an awful lot of leeway to the government rather than giving effect, actually doing what the legislation says. And similarly in 11, to change must to may, that's from mandatory to discretionary, is not flexibility. That to me is weakening it. So I don't accept those amendments. The other amendment, Amendment 15, changing the 6 months to 12 months, I'm not happy about it, but if I have a consideration and undertaking the minister is up to 12 months, then I'm not going to the wall about it. What's 6 months between friends if it's reduced to 7 months, let's say, because it's up to 12 months. So I would be keeping my eye on that timescale. To Finlay Carson, I'm relaxed about what the Delegated Powers Committee wants to do, whether it's positive or negative, because I'm quite relaxed about it. They're experts in this, so it's a matter to them at the end of the day. So I don't have issues with it, and I think I said that previously to you. And to Rhoda Grant, obviously I accept the amendments that insert mandatory at 64, 67, 68 and 70. Oh, I'm sorry, I've jumped a group. I knew I'd go astray. What have I missed? Have I missed one? I think I've missed one. I'm just checking through that. I haven't missed speaking to something I intended to say something about while I've got the chance. I think that's it. My apologies. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. Minister, to wind up.
I have nothing further to add.
And the question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to formally move.
Moved.
And the question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No. Yes.
We are not all agreed. There will be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 6-4, 3 against, no abstentions. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 12 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to formally move.
Moved.
And the question is that Amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a vote. Those members wishing to support the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 7-4, 2 against, no abstentions. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 13 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Move, Convener.
And the question is that Amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 14 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 61 in the name of Finlay Carson, already debated with Amendment 10. Finlay Carson to move or not move? Moved. And the question is that Amendment 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members who wish to abstain. And the result of the vote is 4-4, 5 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 62 in the name of Finlay Carson, already debated with Amendment 10. And I remind members that if Amendment 62 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 15 due to preemption. Finlay Carson to move or not move? Move. So the question is that Amendment 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain? And the result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 15 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to formally move.
Formally move, can we?
And the question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 16 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Move, Convener.
And the question is that Amendment 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of vote is 4, 7 for, 2 against. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 17 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to formally move.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 63 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 63 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. We will move to a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 18 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
And the question is that Amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I now call Amendment 64 in the name of Rhoda Grant, grouped with Amendment 67, 68, 70 and 54. Rhoda Grant to move Amendment 64 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. This section deals with minor and technical aspects of the proposed legislation. The first four amendments are technical adjustments to the wording of the bill. My amendment was proposed, my amendments were proposed by the Law Society of Scotland. So they change words within the bill from must, use the word must rather than is to or are then to. So it clear, makes the bill clearer and easier for members of the public to understand its requirements and intentions. And this would remove ambiguity and strengthen the bill. Amendment 54 looks at Section 12 covering the interpretation of the Act. This section brings forward definitions for central aspects of the bill, such as advertised, first owner, police officer, etc. The intent here is to define the meaning of these terminologies, whereas Amendment 54 removes this section entirely. In closing, these amendments in this group would look at ensuring the bill is implemented as intended, removing ambiguity of language and clearing up interpretation. I would recommend members to support my amendments at this time.
Thank you. I now ask the Minister to speak to Amendment 54 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. I thank Rhoda Grant for the explanation and the purpose of her amendments. The intention when the bill was introduced is recognised in the policy memorandum, which states the intention is to achieve behavioural change without placing formal legal obligations on the parties involved. Now, there is a long-standing convention that codes of practice made under the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006 generally use the word must when there is a directly enforceable legal requirement to do something, which will not be the case in this bill. Therefore, it is the view of the Scottish Government that these amendments are unnecessary and potentially misleading. I therefore do not support these amendments 64, 67, 68 and 70, and I would ask the member not to press them. Amendment 54 in my name leaves out Section 12, the interpretation section of the bill, because the effect of my other amendments is that all of the definitions are either no longer used or are moved to sit within the operational sections to which they relate.
Thank you. Any other members? Christine Graham.
I was generally supportive, actually, of these amendments by Rhoda Grant, but I don't have a vote.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant, to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 64.
Thank you, Convener. I would withdraw and hold until stage three if the Minister was willing to have some discussions around these points to tidy up the bill.
Thank you. So the member has indicated they wish to withdraw the amendment. Does any member object? No. Thank you. I call Amendment 19 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the group. Minister to move Amendment 19 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. These amendments remove the specific questions from the face of the bill as suggested by the committee at stage one. The broad themes underlying the questions will continue to be listed as things the prospective acquirer should consider before acquiring a dog. We do, however, fully understand and share the desire of the member to have the code and certificate written in simple, straightforward language that is easy for the public to understand, and we'd like to give an assurance now that that is what we expect to be produced. The suggestion that Ariane Burgess's amendment that identifying a veterinary practice could be included within the proposed code of practice is a good one, but this sort of detail should be left to be taken forward by officials and the stakeholders as the code is developed. I would therefore ask the member not to press this amendment. I move Amendment 19.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess to speak to Amendment 1 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks very much, Convener. My amendment, the purpose of my amendment is to prompt prospective owners to register a new dog with a vet practice. Regular vet checkups are a key part of responsible dog ownership from puppyhood to old age. Vets are also provide advice and rapid treatment in an emergency, for example, providing out-of-hours care. And an early checkup can identify health issues arising due to negligence by the breeder. A vet may be able to identify other puppies at the practice from the same litter or breed and raise concerns.
Thank you. Any other members? Christine Graham.
Well, I'm going to acquiesce, which is a new place for me to be. While the list of questions in my bill required to be answered are clear and cover key considerations anyone should work through before deciding whether they're able to look after a dog, including the breed, your situation, etc., etc., I've heard what the Minister has to say, and with the assurance which we now have on the record in red letters that the code will be put into plain English, because I want people not to have words like acquirer, environment, if necessary, just if you, you know, someone who's obtaining a dog, getting it, something that's simple to understand, clear English, doesn't need to be complicated, because the questions that I had down in my bill are just the actual questions that anybody would ask themselves. I appreciate it's not legalese language, and I'm happy that it's put into that, but I want the code to be in conversational language, if I can put it like that. With Ariana Burgess' amendment, I think it's a good amendment because actually one of the key things, and the member suggested this, that you might ask the vet if they were aware of the breeder or the bitch who came from them. They're good. They might even, if you went to see them in advance and register with them, you know, give you advice if your query... Could I just, I wonder if Minister, just let me finish my sentence. Oh, I love saying that to a Minister. Anyway, what I want to say is if you went to the vet and said, I'm thinking of getting this breed of dog, it may have breeding issues like the squashed nose, the breed that has been bred so that it can hardly walk, some of the poor devils. That kind of thing the vet can give advice on, or even if you're in the right circumstance, even if you're in the right place in your own life to take it. Vets, in my experience, having had many animals, are excellent, and they will also give you good advice. So I like this. I didn't think of it myself, so I compliment you on it. And I think, Minister, you should give it a bit of thought, if I may suggest. I'm finished, but I'll let you intervene, then I'll say a bit more. So it's an intervention.
Okay. I absolutely agree. I like the recommendation as well. I might even go so far as to say it should be the acquirer and the seller who should both have a notification of who their vet is. I thoroughly agree with everything that Ariane Burgess is saying. I just think that it should be in the code as part of the overall package of what it is that we're actually trying to deliver. It's not that I'm trying to stifle it, and I'm more than happy to meet up with the member during between stage two and stage three in order to clarify that.
Yes, no, I'm glad to see there's been some movement, because I think this is terribly important. I mean, the vets are the very people who don't want to see disasters happening between an owner and their puppy or their dog or an animal that's in poor condition. And we go back again to something that's in the shadows of this bill, which is puppy farming and import of puppies that people buy online. They've no idea. And I think if they have a preliminary meeting with a vet, there's a whole issue there opens up about this, because while this bill doesn't deal directly with it, conveners, you know, at the back of this is the position of people buying puppies out the back of cars, online and so on. So that's the thrust of it, and I think that makes it the vets the very person to be part of that information loop, if I can call it that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Minister, to wind up.
Nothing further to add.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I now call Amendment 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25 and 26, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated with Amendment 19. I invite the Minister to move Amendments 20 to 26 en bloc. Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 20 to 26?
No.
If no member has objected, so the question is that Amendment 20 to 26 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I now call Amendment 1 in the name of Ariane Burgess. Already debated with Amendment 19. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
On the basis of the Minister's offer to meet and discuss this further, I'll not move the amendment. Thank you.
The amendment has not been moved, so it will not be considered. I call Amendment 27 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 19. Minister, to formally move.
Formally move, convener.
The question is that Amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 28 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 19. Minister, to move formally.
Formally move, convener.
The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 29 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 65 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 65 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There'll be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. The result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 30 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. The Minister to formally move.
Moved, convener.
The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 31 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Move formally, can you?
The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
And I call Amendment 32 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the grouping. Ministers, to move Amendments 32 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, convener. Convener, amendments 32, 33 and 36 follow the committee recommendation at stage one to ensure the provision relating to the requirement to see a dog with his mother is worded consistently with the Animal Welfare Licensing Involving Activities Involving Animal Scotland Regulation 2021. This covers circumstances when a dog may be separated from its biological mother for welfare reasons or if the mother is deceased. The Scottish Government agrees with the Committee and the Law Society of Scotland's suggestion that responsibility for confirming a dog is at least 8 weeks old is placed on both the acquirer and the supplier of the dog. The Scottish Government campaigns since 2018 have consistently reinforced to prospective purchasers the importance of seeing a puppy with its mother and ideally at the breeder or seller's premises, as well as verifying the age of the dog. Amendments 39 to 44 place the relevant responsibility on the prospective supplier as well as the prospective acquirer of the dog. And Finlay Carson's Amendment 69 has the same effect as Amendments 39 to 44 in my name, and would therefore ask the member not to press his amendment.
Thank you. Finlay Carson, to speak to Amendment 69 and other amendments in the group. My amendment places a responsibility on both parties to confirm the dog is at least 8 weeks old. Section 3 of the Rural Affairs Stage 1 report states that the code should set out additional requirements in relation to the sale of or transfer of a dog under 12 months old by the first owner of the litter. These include a restriction on the sale of a dog under 8 weeks old, which is also highlighted in the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill. This would extend existing restrictions on the sale of a dog under 8 weeks old from a licensed litter. The 2021 regulations provide that no puppy aged under 8 weeks may be sold or permanently separated from its biological mother, and a puppy should only be shown to a prospective purchaser if it is together with its biological mother. The only circumstances this not apply is if it's necessary for the puppy's health or welfare, or the puppy's biological mother has deceased. This amendment places, it recommends placing a responsibility on both parties to confirm that the dog meets this age requirement. The Law Society of Scotland agrees with the amendment and recommends that Section 4, 4B of the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill be amended that to both the buyer and the seller confirms that the puppy is at least 8 weeks old. Any other members? Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm actually content with all of the government amendments as they're making the language in the bill clearer in a number of ways. This includes being supportive of the changes and seeing the mother with the puppy and ensuring the puppy is at least 8 weeks old. And I've listened to you, Convener, but it does seem to me to duplicate what the government's already doing. And if I've got that wrong, I'll be interested to hear what is said. But I don't have a vote, so I'm just listening to this particular debate.
Thank you. Jim, Minister, to wind up.
Nothing further to add, Convener.
Thank you. So the question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 33 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 32. Minister, to move formally.
Moved formally.
The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I now call Amendment 34 in the name of the Minister, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Minister, to move Amendment 34 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener. Convener, these amendments leave out sections 8 to 11 of the bill on powers to make regulations regarding the registration of litters and to make consequential amendments to remove references to Part 2 from the bill and its long title. Scottish Government is pleased that the committee agreed at stage one that part two of the bill should be removed. I understand that the member accepts this on the clear understanding that we will continue working with other GB administrations to explore the improvement of the existing compulsory dog microchipping legislation, in particular exploring the potential for a single point of access to all dog microchip records to be created across GB and for details of dog breeders to be permanently recorded. Existing powers under Section 27 of the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006 to establish registration schemes mean that new primary legislation in this area is not needed to allow us to introduce that registration if circumstances change in the future. And I move Amendment 34.
Any other members? Christine Graham.
Yes, absolutely correct in what the Minister says. I did confirm to the committee at stage one of the bill that I was content to remove at stage two. It was pretty onerous, a bit clunky and financially onerous at this time. And that said, as the committee was aware, I really was very interested in a UK-based microchipping database, which makes more sense because as an ancillary to that, you can actually put dog control notices on it as well, have everything that's relevant to the dogs in Scotland. So I have no concerns about the deletion of part two, given that I agreed to it earlier. Could hardly change my mind now on the basis that we continue to look at microchipping.
Thank you.
I think we've got a debate on that later, so I'll save stuff for later on that I want to say.
Thank you. Minister, to wind up.
Nothing further to add.
So the question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 35 in the name of the Minister, already debated the Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
So the question is that Amendment 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 36 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 32. Minister, to move formally.
Moved formally, convener.
So the question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 66 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 66 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There'll be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against, no abstentions. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 37 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 6. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
The question is that Amendment 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 67 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 64. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not move.
The member has not moved, so we will not consider that amendment. I call Amendment 68 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 64. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Not moved.
The amendment has not been moved, so it will not be considered. I call Amendments 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated, and invite the Minister to move Amendments 38 to 44 en bloc.
Moved en bloc, convener.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 38 to 44? No member objects. So the question is that Amendments 38 to 44 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 69.9 in the name of Fernie Carson, already debated with Amendment 32. Fernie Carson, to move or not move? Not moved. The amendment has not been moved and will not be considered. I call Amendment 2 in the name of Ariane Burgess, grouped with Amendment 3. Ariane Burgess, to move Amendment 2 and speak to all other amendments in the group.
Thanks, convener. I move Amendment 2. Amendment 2 adds an additional requirement that a person acquiring a dog must seek the dog's existing health records and contact details of the vet practice it is registered with. Confirmation of this would be included on the certificate. This is similar to Amendment 1. It ensures the importance of ongoing veterinary care is reflected in the code of practice and increases the chances of a prospective new owner being fully informed of any pre-existing health or behavioural conditions. If a seller can't provide this information, it should be recognised as a clear red flag. Amendment 3 strengthens the requirement on both the supplier and the acquirer to provide contact information to be included in the certificate, email and phone number, in addition to postal address. This enhances the traceability of both the breeder, original owner, and the new owner. 10.6 million dogs in the UK, of that, only 33% are acquired from professional breeders, and a vast majority come from online sellers. This recognises that many adverts for dogs and the subsequent transactions are taking place online. The code of practice should reflect that we are living in a digital age. And I've had discussions with SSPCA, and they have highlighted the need to recognise that dogs are increasingly being advertised online.
Thank you. Any other members? Rhoda Grant.
Could I just have a query? Why email addresses are being included on the face of the bill. Not everyone has an email address, and I wonder if the member would consider removing that at stage 3 in case it prohibits anyone fulfilling the terms of the
bill. Well, thanks for that question from Rhoda Grant. I would imagine that if people don't have an email address, they wouldn't have to supply an email address, but we want to have contact information of the people, and the point of the amendment is pointing out that we are increasingly living in a digital age, and most people do have emails. I actually say to people, if you can get away in this world without having an email address, you're very fortunate.
Some people don't.
any other members?
No.
The Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and I thank Arianne Burgess for explaining the purpose of her amendments 2 and 3. However, I cannot agree with these amendments that I believe they're unnecessary, because it is the intention of the Scottish Government to develop the details and the contents of the proposed certificate with stakeholders. By having items specified in the bill, this would restrict what can be decided in conjunction with the stakeholders, and including additional personal information on the certificate is considered to be unnecessary and is the sort of detail that is best left to the further development of the code by officials and stakeholders. So therefore, I cannot support these amendments. And the intervention from Rhoda Grant actually demonstrates exactly why we should have these discussions when we're developing the code, as opposed to while we're sitting in the committee. So I'd ask the member not to press that.
Christine Graham.
Much, Convener. I'm very supportive of the policy intention behind these amendments from Arianna Burgess. I hear what the Minister has to say. I'm particularly interested in concluding provisions such as the transfer of any health records. We're back to this issue of not always, but broadly speaking, when these we've imported puppies from puppy farms, then they have usually dreadful health conditions and behavioural problems, is well documented. So I very much welcome that, but I hear what the Minister has to say and I'm interested to see what happens further with the committee.
Thank you. Arianne Burgess to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 2.
Thank you, Convener. I've gotten... I take Rhoda Grant's point and also the Minister's point on Amendment 3 in terms of the detail and that being developed. But I do think there is merit, and I take on board Christine Graham's comment, that there is merit in the health records being connected to the transaction. And so with that, I'd like to press Amendment 2.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 45 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 46 and 4, and I point out if Amendment 46 agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 4 due to preemption. Minister, to move Amendment 45 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, these amendments address the concern that arose during Stage 1 that the bill could be misconstrued as creating a direct legal obligation for the acquirer to create, sign and keep the certificate and to show it to a police officer or inspector if required, if requested, I should say. The intention is to make clear that Section 4 is detailing what the Code of Practice must include in relation to the certificate, which we otherwise fully support, but that Section 4 is not in itself imposing any direct legal obligations on the acquirer or the supplier of a dog. As the bill does not provide for any sanctions or penalties in the event that a person does not comply with sections 2 to 4 of the bill, these provisions cannot be enforced directly in practice. I understand this was the intention when the bill was introduced, and it is recognised in the policy memorandum, which states the intention is to achieve behavioural change without placing formal legal obligations on the parties involved. If Amendments 45 and 46 are passed, failing to complete and hold a certificate may still be relevant to establishing a liability as set out in section 6 for the other provisions of the Code of Practice, and could be taken into account by the relevant enforcement authorities when considering further action under the Animal Health and Welfare Scotland Act 2006 or regulations made under the Act in individual cases where owners have acted irresponsibly. The amendments will, however, avoid any misunderstanding or unnecessary anxiety for otherwise law-abiding and responsible owners who might misplace their certificate and be concerned that simply failing to retain a completed certificate to show to a police officer or an inspector would in itself be an offence that could lead to a prosecution. Akanya.
Thank you, Minister, for taking the intervention. I am concerned about these amendments 45 and 46, because would the Minister be able to, at this stage, give any examples of how this could compare to wildlife welfare legislation in terms of not providing a certificate if asked.
I'm sorry, I don't understand where you're going with that.
Well, if on 45, if I'm reading this amendment correctly, the potential owner no longer has to confirm that they understand that they must keep the certificate for the duration of the ownership of the dog. And in terms of 46, the certificate no longer has to be shown to the police. So is this consistent with any other welfare legislation, perhaps in wildlife rather than kept animals?
Well, I haven't considered it in terms of the wildlife. I'm considering it specifically in the case of this bill, which, as we've stated, is as a guidance rather than something that we can enforce legally. So therefore, the requirement to produce a certificate or to hold a certificate may give the impression to people that there is a legal requirement to do so, and therefore that it could be prosecuted if they didn't have it. And that is unfair on the people that we are asking to fill out these certificates in the first place, because there isn't a legal requirement. There is no legal penalty for not having the ability to produce it.
Okay, so can I just press you a little bit more? So if they don't keep the certificate, it's not a legal requirement. They don't have to produce it. The only reason that you're putting this amendment is because of the perception that having a certificate is not necessary.
And is to get the proposition that the member had wanted right at the start, which is that people take due care and attention when they're actually going to buy a dog and when they're going to be selling a dog and getting all the relevant details. But there is no legal penalty for not having the certificate. So therefore, not requiring that certificate to be held for the rest of its life is not something that we think is fair from the point of view that these people, they then believe that they are legally bound to have done so.
I'll maybe wait till Christine Graham's explanation of this, but if a person who buys a dog gets a certificate, they just rip it up and put it in the bin. Thanks.
Thank you. Continue, Minister.
Okay, I'm going to go back. The amendment will, however, avoid any misunderstanding or unnecessary anxiety for otherwise law-abiding and responsible owners who might misplace their certificate and be concerned that simply failing to retain a completed certificate to show to a police officer or an inspector would in itself be an offence that could lead to prosecution. So therefore it follows that I cannot agree with Amendment 4 requiring the certificate to be shown to a veterinary surgeon on request. Even if my amendments were unsuccessful and Section 4.5b remained in the bill, registered vets do not have similar enforcement powers to police or inspectors. It is not clear if vets in practice would want to become involved in investigations involving their clients. This would need to have been discussed and agreed with the veterinary professional bodies if they were to be included in the bill. Therefore, we cannot mandate them to do this without thorough consultation. I move Amendment 45.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess to speak to Amendment 4 and other amendments in the group.
My Amendment 4 builds on my earlier amendments by recognising the crucial role of vets in ensuring dogs' welfare. And it would require an owner to show their certificate to a vet as well as a police officer or inspector if asked. This can help a vet acquire all the information needed to effectively treat a sick dog, and it can also help a practice trace other animals from a negligent breeder owner that might be similarly affected. And I think this amendment is also about explicitly acknowledging the crucial role that vets can play throughout the whole certificate process.
Any other members? Oh, Christine Graham.
Well, on the government amendments, the code of practice and associated certificate are not legally binding. I think it's helpful to the committee if I quote from the existing code of practice for the welfare of dogs in the preface, second paragraph. Generally, there is a duty to comply with legislation. Although the code does not have legislative effect, it is intended to promote and give examples of good practice. Here's the killer line. Failure to comply with the provision of this code, whilst not an offence in itself, may be relied upon as tending to establish liability when a person has been accused of an offence under Part 2 of the Act. Paragraph next sentence. Equally, compliance with the provision of the code may be relied upon as tending to negate liability by a person in any proceedings for an offence under Part 2 of the Act. Now, without being too boring, at Section 6, Subsection 2 of my bill, quotes, A, failure to comply with a relevant provision of the Code of Practice may be relied on as tending to establish liability, and B, compliance with a relevant provision of the Code of Practice may be relied on as tending to negative liability, lifted straight from the previous Code of Practice. So I can't see the problem. All my bill is doing is replicating what's in the existing Code of Practice to this. It is evidential. It's nothing to do with perception. I beg your pardon? Yes, certainly, yes.
My understanding of what the Minister was saying was that none of this is legally binding, other than if you put it on the face of the bill. So that's why those bits are being removed, because they in themselves would become they in themselves would become crucial. People would have to comply with that, albeit that they wouldn't have to comply with the code itself.
I'm sorry, I couldn't quite hear all that. All I'm trying to put to the committee is this, that my bill pretty well replicates what exists in the existing Code of Practice under the Animal Welfare Act, which has, once you're in possession of a dog, in fact, 6.1 says, a failure to, this is my bill, a failure to comply with any provision of the Code of Practice does not of itself make the person liable to proceedings of any sort. Now, it's just almost word for word, if I may say so, what's in the existing Code of Practice. So I can't see what the problem is here and why it's going to be different in this particular bill from the, producing the Code of Practice than the existing Code of Practice in the Scottish Government's own words. As for, in addition to asking someone to confirm whether they understand these consequences when they're getting a dog, with means of ensuring, amongst other questions of the certificate, that the acquirer understands the commitment of getting a dog. It's important that they understand that. And I take the same view, in fact, of my colleague, Rachel Hamilton, that there's no point in it if it's nothing. But whereas it's not to do with perception, it's to do with evidential, and it's not punitive, it's educational, and it shows there's been engagement between the acquirer and the person transferring the dog at the time when the transfer takes place. They're both committed to this, they've read and understood it. And as I say, it's not legally binding, but neither was this one. It's exactly the same language. So I have to say, and I'll put this down right now, this is a red line for me, and that I intend, if this, if the amendment, the government's amendments succeed, I will be coming back at stage three. I may tweak it a little, but I'll be coming back with the same thrust at stage three. And with regard to, I think that's particularly everything I want to say about, yes, and about Arianna Burgess's amendments. Again, I think that the role of veterinary surgeons is extremely important here, and I'm very sympathetic.
Thank you. Minister, to wind up.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a quote here from the committee itself. The committee also notes, however, that Christine Graham's objective for the bill is to educate rather than penalise, which she has just clarified herself. Rather than penalise those acquiring or selling, giving away a dog, and agrees with the advisory status of the certificate. And if amendments 45 and 46 are passed, failing to complete and hold the certificate may still be relevant in establishing liability as set out in Section 6 for other provisions of the Code of Practice, could be taken into account by the relevant welfare of enforcement authorities. In other words, if you don't have a certificate, why? Why don't you have it? Therefore, that gathers the evidence for the... I will, yeah.
That my wording is lifted word for word from this Code of Practice, the government's very own Code of Practice, saying, although the code does not have legislative effect, promote examples of good practice, etc., etc. It's duplicating it. Is that not the case?
From the 2010, but we have a separate entity, which is exactly what you as the member have brought
forward.
That
wasn't my question, Minister. My minister is, does my wording duplicate the wording in the existing code?
Well, I don't have the 2010 one in front of me, but if you're telling me it was, I will accept that as your position. However, that doesn't alter the fact that what we have is a bill which you have brought forward and that we support, but allowing people to believe that they have committed a criminal offence when they haven't is not fair, and therefore I think that amendment should pass.
If I may just, this is rather important, if I have your... I would like to convene, if I may, with your leave. Nobody's creating a criminal offence. It's absolutely it's patently obvious here. And I think the problem for the Minister, if I'm quite frank, is in pretty thin ice. If I lift language straight from existing code of practice, which makes it plain that it is not have legislative effect but promote examples of good practice, and then I lift everything else and put it straight into my bill, I cannot see the grounds for arguing that I'm doing something punitive and different from an existing code of practice that the government drafted itself.
I was just going to point out to Christine Graham, we're actually leaving that same wording in the bill. It'll be there.
I'm very conscious we don't want to start a conversation. Minister, you're winding up, and if Ms Graham wishes to intervene, she can do that. Could you please continue?
I've got nothing further to add, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a vote. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members abstaining. And the result of the vote is 6 for, 2 against, 1 abstention. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with Amendment 2. Ariane Burgess to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your...
Jumped ahead to Amendment 4. I'm actually not going to move that amendment.
Okay, we'll jump back. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with Amendment 2. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Not move.
The amendment has not been moved and so will therefore not be considered. I call Amendment 70 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 64. Rhoda Grant to move or not move?
Not move.
The amendment has not been moved, so it will not be considered. Amendment 45 in the name of, I beg your pardon. Yeah, I call Amendment 46 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 45. And I remind members that if Amendment 46 agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 4 due to preemption. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 6 for, 2 against and 1 abstention. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I now call Amendment 71 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 71 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members who wish to abstain, please raise your hand now. And the result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 47 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Convener.
The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not all agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. I'm going to call that a vote again. Those members supporting Amendment 47, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. The result of the vote is 7 for, 2 against. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 48 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moves, convened.
The question is that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There'll be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members abstaining. And the result of the vote is 7 for, 2 against. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 72 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 10. Rhoda Grant, to move or not?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 72 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 73 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 73 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting. Those members wishing to abstain. The result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 49 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, Convener.
And the question is that Amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 74 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 74 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members abstaining. Well, the result of the vote is 2 for, 7 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 75 in the name of Finlay Carson, grouped with Amendment 76 and 5. Finlay Carson, to move Amendment 75 and speak to all amendments in the group. I move Amendment 75. This amendment will make it a statutory requirement to introduce a public awareness campaign and to specify that children must be made aware of the code at school. The Stage 1 report produced by the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee noted in Section 7 that the Scottish Ministers must take responsible steps to ensure public awareness and understanding of the Code of Practice. It made reference to the policy memorandum stating, and I quote, "For the behavioural shift envisaged to take place, effective public awareness raising will be vital in ensuring those acquiring a dog become aware of and understand the contents of the Code and associated certificate." Close quotes. According to the report, all witnesses support Section 7 and strongly agreed that a public awareness campaign would be essential in order for the Bill's objective to be achieved. And the Stage 1 report referenced the Kennel Club's PuppyWise survey, which found a fifth of people still spend less than 2 hours researching whether to get a puppy. And almost a third admitted they would not know how to spot a rogue breeder. It concluded that, and I quote, "For us, the educational piece is really important because ultimately we need members of the public to demand better standards of breeders." However, several animal welfare organisations spoke about the challenges of awareness campaigns having a meaningful impact on public behaviour. The Dogs Trust referred to the very low public awareness of the existing code of practice for cats and dogs. The Scottish SPCA spoke about people following their hearts, not their heads, and that they know that standing in a car park with a puppy in the boot of a car is the wrong thing to do, but they think, "I want to go rescue that puppy because who else is going to do it?" That is why the amendment recommended making a public awareness campaign a statutory requirement. We also believe that children should be made aware of this in schools. New pet population data was released from UK Pet Food claiming that 56% of new pet owners have children at home. And that was in 2024. And in more long-term ownership, the National Library for Medicine found that almost 20% of all dog owners had a child at home. Therefore, it can be summarised that a sizeable proportion of dog owners have children. So targeting a public awareness at schools would reach a sizeable demographic of pet owners. So a public awareness campaign with the code of practice explained in simple terms would be effective. My amendment 76 also makes it mandatory for the Scottish Government to consult with relevant organisations on raising funds for public awareness. I think it's incredibly important that the Government works with and consults those organisations such as the RSPCA, Dogs Trust, the Kennel Club, the Battersea Dogs Home and SSPCA to ensure that any public awareness campaign is maximised. And those discussions should also take place around the potential funding for public awareness campaigns. Ariane Burgess to speak to Amendment 5 and other amendments in the group.
My Amendment 5 strengthens the requirement on ministers to raise public awareness of the code of practice. Specifically, government must identify resources that is needed to effectively communicate information about the new code to the public. This could prompt consideration about the format information is in and reach different groups, and other considerations such as provisions in other languages and accessible formats. At a time of constrained public finances, it is important to include this requirement in primary legislation to ensure that the new code has an impact. And I see this very much as a preventative spend, because if we actually get people aware and informed, we can kind of stem the flow or tide of all the knock-on effects that Christine Graham is trying to do with this bill. And I, in terms of Amendments 50, 75 and 76, in the name of Finlay Carson, I agree that public awareness with school pupils is a great approach, because it is often the young people who are asking for that puppy. And certainly in terms of Amendment 76, consulting with organisations who have an interest in welfare of dogs and how they can contribute to future steps is an important piece as well.
Oh, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to thank the Convener for explaining the purposes of his amendments. I cannot agree that Amendment 75 is necessary, because it is the intention of the Scottish Government that a renewed publicity campaign to raise awareness of the proposed code would be essential in educating the public about unscrupulous breeding and selling of dogs, the criminality behind the illegal trade and other serious welfare issues that can arise when acquiring a puppy. Previous marketing campaigns have carefully considered the target demographic of prospective dog buyers, and therefore the Scottish Government want to keep the flexibility to develop awareness campaigns in the most appropriate and cost-effective way in conjunction with the main animal welfare organisations, without detailed requirements of this sort being specified on the bill. Although I understand the intention behind this proposal and agree that raising the awareness of children and young people is important, I think it is preferable to leave the decisions about exactly how campaigning should be targeted to the marketing professionals in this area. I therefore cannot support Amendment 75, and I would ask the member not to press it. I would, however, be happy to support Mr. Carson's Amendment 76, particularly as previous campaigns in which we have worked with relevant stakeholders, including the Scottish SPCA, have proved successful in raising public awareness. On Ariane Burgess's Amendment 5, Section 7 of the bill already includes a duty on Scottish ministers to take reasonable steps to ensure public awareness and understanding of the code of practice. And it is the view of the Scottish Government that taking reasonable steps would, by implication, include ensuring where suitable, including, let me try that again, implication would include ensuring there were suitable resources available. So this amendment is unnecessary. We expect that publicising the new code will require a significant public awareness raising campaign, ideally with coordinated messaging from the main welfare organisations and enforcement agencies. We will be working with the stakeholder organisations to consider the most effective way of doing this, and I hope that this reassures Ariane Burgess and ask her not to press her amendment.
Thank you for taking the intervention, Minister. Obviously, in the past, the government have had awareness campaigns, but we have no idea how effective those campaigns...
Now of how effective these campaigns have been, if you'd like to hear them.
Well, we wouldn't be bringing forward further legislation if the campaigns had originally been effective. Whilst I'm supportive of 75 and 76, Finlay Carson's amendments and Ariane Burgess's amendments, I think it's important. What I'm trying to ask you, Minister, is whether you think at stage 3 we should be looking at how effective the awareness campaigns are and bringing forward an amendment to reflect that.
Well, as I said, we have all the facts and figures of how aware of how effective these campaigns were. But I think I will point out one of the things that you've just said there. We have all accepted in the deliberations of this bill going forward that this bill in itself will not eradicate the problems we have with puppy trades. The previous stuff is not going to eradicate the problems we had with puppy trades. And this will be an ongoing process because criminals will always find a way to try and get round
Minister,
the law.
Give way.
I will, yeah.
Thank you, Minister, for giving me. So I'm just reflecting on advertising and campaigns because during my livestock worrying legislation and other raising awareness of when to buy a puppy, like, so I've been able to bring puppies into Parliament. So I agree with you that there needs to be a flexible approach to how we market, whether it's National Farmers Union in the case of livestock worrying or Police Scotland, they also help. So I think looking at the changes to how we use social media and marketing would actually be in your favour. So I'm in agreement with you that we have to have a flexible approach to how we raise awareness in the campaigns.
Okay. All I can say is that the purpose behind it, we absolutely accept everything that the bill is trying to do, and we have it in the provisions that there will need to be a considerable marketing campaign to make sure that people are aware of this. The fact that the bill is passed in itself will be a light-up moment for what we are trying to do here. So, therefore, the amendments, the one that we are supporting, I accept, we're happy to do that. The other bits, I'm just not quite sure that they're as necessary as being put into the face of the bill.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
Rachel Hamilton has been helpful in a sense that perhaps didn't mean to be about mine being single targeted before you acquire a puppy or a dog, because any publicity campaign would be aimed simply at that directly, about buying online out the back of a car in a lorry or thinking you're rescuing, all the things we know that serious organised crime uses, because we know these puppies cost £3,500-£4,000 and there's maybe six crammed into a crate. They've been taken away from their mothers, not socialised. All these things we know. So that's why this code is here, is to get people to focus very narrowly on that, because it's still happening. Yes, of course, of course.
If we're being pedantic about this, the public awareness and understanding of the code amendment doesn't specifically set out that it will deal with those issues in itself.
I agree, but that's not the point. You can't do that in this bill. But then we
but
can
you have just said that, Ms. Graham.
Because there's... Well, let me progress and we'll answer also the Minister. That what we require, the Minister quite rightly says, when a bill comes before, a member's bill, I'm talking about member's bills, and I've moaned on about this before to Public Audit Committee when doing post-legislative scrutiny of member's bills. They get a bit of publicity, air of publicity, when they're lodged. They get an air of publicity when they pass. Then they're left on the shelf. Now, my view in here is, in a democratic parliament, all bills are equal once Parliament has passed them. So that a member's bill, not just mine, any member's bill that passes in this Parliament should have the resources and the publicity that the government would give to their own ones, let's say minimum unit pricing or UK ones that don't drink and drive, the ones that we know about. This one, and I would be looking to, obviously the government has to consult with the various charities and so on, but what your audience is, who are you targeting? Well, you're targeting people that click a button, see a nice wee puppy, rather like the one, unfortunately, you see, this is what I've got against it, a wee charming wee thing in here. They never have Rex on the front. They don't have dogs that have been, they're not pretty. But, you know, so the pretty dogs, you see them online, it's like buying a handbag. They spend longer buying a handbag or a pair of trainers. Oh, it's lovely, I'll buy. It's to make them reflect, where's this puppy from? Why am I in the car park looking at one and saying, a better, if I don't get it, it's going to, you know, it's going to perish. No, what's going to happen if you buy it out the back of a crate? Another puppy is going to come off the production line, you know, to be miserable and fulfil that place. So my thing about publicity, well, I don't think, I'm quite content with the government and what should be in the face of the bill here. But my thing about this is, and I've banged on about ages, is I expect publicity for all members' bills to be appropriate, and not just to rely on when they first get through Parliament or if something controversial happens to tell people about it. Control of Dogs Bill, which I brought through, Control of Dogs Act. I know there are police who don't know about it. I would imagine Emma Harper is aware there are police who don't know about her bill, because it's not a government bill, it's a member's bill, and to me they're all of equal merit once Parliament passes it. So my message to the government, it's not this minister's fault, because I've said this to previous ministers, and this is, I want to see a change in the culture of publicising members' bills, not just mine.
Thank you. Finlay Carson, to wind up and press withdraw amendment 75, intend to press amendment 75. I just appeal to members, and because I'm sure they're aware that the pressure that children can put on parents, whether that was the effectiveness of a seatbelt ban in cars or a smoking ban, it's often the children that put the pressure on the parents. And from the evidence I've stated earlier, there is a significant number of new dog owners. 56% have children in the home. I think that there is no undesirable outcomes from...
I completely understand the logic behind the amendment that the member is putting, and I can see where he wants to go with it. But again, if we put it in the face of the bill, would it not be better to leave the decision as to where this marketing is going to happen? You've actually said that in the committee stage one report, maximising its marketing expertise. The Scottish Government maximises its marketing expertise. Allow that to be done by the people who know how to do the marketing rather than this committee.
Thank you. I say that the amendment, as far as I can see, doesn't have any undesirable outcomes, is not unduly burdensome on the government to deliver. But it's quite clear that children are going to play a huge part and ensuring we have that change in attitude toward buying pets. So I will still push, because I think it's really important that there are reasonable steps taken to ensure that awareness and understanding of the code of practice is there with school children. I will.
It seems the minister's hanging his hat on the expertise, or the so-called expertise, of the Scottish Government. And if we look at other policies that the Scottish Government have brought forward, such as MUP, they've not necessarily been successful. And I think, actually, the words that have been used correctly here, for example, from Arianne Burgess, in a preventative agenda, ensuring that the funding is behind this, taking into account what Christine Graham has said, I think it's really important that we get to the sort of the root of changing the future in terms of that awareness. And I think your amendment is entirely sensible. I'm surprised... I understand what the government are trying to say, that they don't want it on the face of the bill, but perhaps it should be on the face of the bill if they look in hindsight of some of the other policies that they brought forward that clearly haven't worked.
Thank you. Yep, I agree 100%. I'll just go back. I'm not going to labour the point anymore. I think there is no issues surrounding this amendment. It's reasonable steps the amendment suggests, and I think it's quite clear that the majority of people realise the importance of the pressure that children could put on parents. So I would urge members to put aside their party political whip and look at this amendment as a sensible amendment and ensuring that the marketing of this new bill is done in an appropriate way. So I press Amendment 75. The question is that Amendment 75 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of the amendment, raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members wishing to abstain. And the result of the vote is 5 for, 4 against. The amendment has therefore been agreed. I call Amendment 76 in the name of Finlay Carson, already debated with Amendment 75. Finlay Carson to move or not move? I move. So the question is that Amendment 76 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of Arianne Burgess, already debated with Amendment 75. Arianne Burgess to move or not move?
Moved.
Moved. And the question is that Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment, Those members wishing to abstain? No. Sorry, I'm going to run that vote again. Can we make sure everybody keeps their hands up until the clerks have recorded it? So those supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members not supporting the amendment? Those members abstaining? So the result of the vote is 4 for, 5 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 77 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 60. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move? That amendment has not been moved, so will not be considered. So the question is that Section 7 is agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 50 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
The question is that Amendment 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 51 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 52 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
The question is that Amendment 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 53 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved, convener.
And the question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I now call Amendment 59 in the name of Edward Mountain, grouped with Amendments 79 and 78. Edward Mountain, to move Amendment 59 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Sorry, thank you very much, convener. Before I go any further, I'd like to remind members of my register of interest in that I am a farmer and part of a farming partnership. I would also point out I'm a dog owner and have recently registered puppies, and I'm an honorary member of the British Veterinary Association. And so I'd like to speak to Amendment 59, and I am going to move it. And I'm going to move it for three really good reasons, which I'm sure everyone will find easy to support. First of all, it's good for dogs and their welfare. It allows the government to carry out some post-legislative scrutiny, and it will help address the issue of dog theft, which is subject to a separate bill being brought by another member. I'm sure I don't need to remind the Minister, in 2016, the rules for microchipping were brought in. We are 8 years post that situation, and we are in a situation where we don't know if it works. We're in the situation where there is a requirement to microchip your puppy at 8 weeks, and you're supposed to update your dog when you move it and sell it around the country on when you change your address or your telephone number, or you indeed sell it to somebody else or give it to somebody else. Now, we're pretty sure that doesn't happen across the country. There are thousands of strays every year that aren't properly recorded on a database. And I'm sure the Minister will say, well, there's 12 properly accredited databases in Scotland. And he'd be right, but there's 22 across the United Kingdom. So which one is being checked, which one is being kept up to date, and which one is the proper one to use? Now, you know, when we're farming, we have a simple situation where we have Scot EID, where we record our animals on a database, and every animal has a passport, and we know where they are, and we know their history. And now the government's produced a poultry register. So if you have one chicken at home scratching around your door, you have to register it. And you have to record that on a database that the government keeps. And so everyone's used to doing this with animals in the countryside. And it's a good basis. And we do it when we have our car. We have a responsibility to keep the VO5 up to date and record any changes on it. So my suggestion in this bill is that the government think carefully about their legislation of 2016 and consider whether it's actually working.
and I have asked them to review it, to check the suitability of whether the micro whether the databases and the microchipping is working properly, and they should consult about with breeders and acquirers of dogs, owners of dogs, and they should consult with veterinary practitioners. Now, I'm a believer, and I know it's a step too far for some people, that vets should check their dogs when they come into a veterinary practice to make sure that it is properly microchipped, so they can see that the person who brings it in is indeed the correct owner. That may be a step too far now, but I think it should come in due course. But my amendment is a simple one, Minister. It's putting an onus on the government to check the legislation that they brought in 2016 is working correctly, is effective, and is doing what it's supposed to do, which is looking after the welfare of dogs. I don't see what's not to like about it, but I suspect, Minister, you're going to tell me. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I call Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 79 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And I thought Edward Mountain was yoking when he talked about having to register one chicken. Amendment 79 requires Scottish ministers to introduce a new microchip database and has been drafted based on Section 8 of the Control of Dog Scotland Act 2010, which introduced a dog control database. As noted in the Stage 1 committee reports, and relevant stakeholder groups such as the Scottish SPCA, and I quote, gave evidence about the challenges of checking microchip details across the different databases for different manufacturers. Amendment 79 seeks to enhance and improve traceability by creating a microchip database. Moreover, as drafted, Amendment 79 creates an obligation for ministers to work with the UK government, which was recognised in the Stage 1 debate and in the Stage 1 committee report as being important for workability and effectiveness. And we've already heard a brief summary from Christine Graham on that. I do have the costs if the ministers interested, but I won't go into them specifically. Amendment 78 requires ministers to conduct a review and publish a report every 2 years on whether a centralised database containing the microchip details of dogs should be used to monitor the acquisition of dogs, the transfer of dogs and the microchipping of puppies. This amendment also requires the Scottish Government to consult with stakeholders on a centralised microchip database. Additionally, as with my previous amendment in this group, Amendment 78 also creates an obligation for the Scottish Government to work collaboratively with the UK Government. And I appreciate my discussion with Christine Graham on this and that she is supportive. Thank you.
Members? No. Minister?
My apologies. Thank you, Convener. And I'd like to thank Edward Mountain for explaining the purpose of Amendment 59 and Rachel Hamilton for explaining the purpose of our Amendment 78. And as these are very similar amendments, I will address the views of the Scottish Government on them together. The Scottish Government officials are working with our counterparts and other UK administrations to explore the potential of a single point search portal for all microchip database operators across the UK in order to provide transparency to obtain relevant information when required. This work would incorporate the information that the review this amendment is requesting and could address the issue that is being raised. It is felt that resource would be better spent working with other UK administrations on this work than undertaking a review and producing a separate report. I therefore do not support the amendments 59 and 78, and I would ask members not to press them.
Could the Minister outline what progress has been made towards working with the UK Government on a single microchip database?
Specifically on the microchip database, I haven't had any formal discussions with the UK Government. However, I did attend a meeting in London on Monday where I had a conversation with Andrew Muir, the Northern Irish delegate for agriculture in Northern Ireland. We talked about the problems with Larne and puppies coming across from there, and we've started the conversation about how this bill could help to inform a UK-wide approach to creating a database to allow us to get over this problem. We're taking it extremely seriously. It's just that at this stage, the resources that it would take, rather than setting up a separate Scottish database, we would rather do it on a UK-wide basis.
Yeah. Take an intervention.
Yeah.
Sorry, was that?
Either or.
Thank you. So what you're suggesting is my amendment 59, which calls for a review, should be rejected on the basis of an informal conversation with one member of a devolved administration in the United Kingdom and no members of the United Kingdom administration. Do you think that's really going to fly with people out there? Just some chit-chat at a meeting?
Would you like to bring your intervention as well, Rachel?
Yes, please. Thank you, Minister. I did indicate that I had worked with the very helpful Bill team, and they had, in relation to Amendment 79, stated that the costs were estimated at £140,000 in the initial year to establish a database, and further adding that costs, therefore, are more difficult to estimate, but it seems likely the cost would fall around £100,000. And obviously, there would have to be a financial memorandum if they were over £500,000. However, at the costs estimated by the Bill team at £140,000, I would say, Minister, would you not agree that that's good value compared to perhaps the potential of a long, protracted conversation with the UK government, where the Scottish government are entirely able to bring forward at quite a relatively small cost compared to other costs that happen in this place, to bring forward its own database?
At this stage, no. At this stage, I'm very happy to be working with the UK government. We have had a marked change in the attitude of how things could be developed. The meeting that we had with the new Secretary of State for Rural Affairs and Agriculture was very amenable. It's quite clear that they're very keen on working together. And regardless of the point that Edward Mountain makes that it's chit-chat, it's not chit-chat. If you're having these conversations, it's in order to progress things in a serious manner. And I will reiterate again, we are taking this very seriously. The idea of a UK-wide database that has all the requirements that the members are putting are what we are trying to achieve, and it would be far better to do that on a UK-wide basis rather than a Scottish-only basis. If we go ahead with these amendments, what it will do is it will tie up time, it will tie up resource, it will commit money that could actually be better spent by using a UK-wide system, which is what it is that we are endeavouring to do.
Yes,
I will, yeah.
On the point about the resource for this and the time...
Sorry, I can't hear you.
On the point about the resource and the time that it would take, within the Stage 1 report, we, as a committee, asked for the Scottish Government to get back to us as to how the conversation...
Could you go closer to your mic?
Sorry. Is there something wrong with the microphone? Can you hear me? Right, OK. It does seem a little strange, but there we go. So, in the Stage 1 report, we had recommended that we'd asked the Scottish Government to come back to us to give us an update on progress with conversations with the UK Government. However, would it be possible for the Scottish Government to come back before Stage 3 with an update on what the likely costs will be and any further conversations and a plan as to how this could work? Because, you know, I mean, I'm likely to press my amendment just to see the support around the room and hear what Christine Graham's got to say as well. But, I mean, if this is to fly, Minister, we need to have confidence that the Scottish Government, you're promising this, but we need to have confidence that my costs... compared to your costs, you've just said that you could do it pretty cost effectively. But how are we to know that?
Okay. Are you finished? Sorry.
I am finished.
Okay. I will reiterate the point that I've made. We are very keen to make sure that we progress to a UK-wide database that will work in exactly the way that people are want. I'm happy to speak to the member between now and Stage 3 and give you any updates if we can before Stage 3, if there are any updates at that point. But I would reiterate the point that we're very serious about trying to get this done. It's not something that we're trying to just brush off.
Are you concluding? Yes.
Concluding, yeah.
Thank you. Christine Graham.
You're on a hobby horse of mine here, Edward, and you've been terribly patient and waiting to the end, but it's very important. I've long thought that microchipping, we should have a central database. It's common sense. If I give the comparison with dog control notices, which originally were just registered in the council area, which was pretty useless because people could move their dog from one place to another, and now we have a Scottish database and dog control notices. So that was done. I'm not saying it's as easy to do this. I'm very sympathetic. I have no vote in this, of course, but I'm very sympathetic to review of what we actually have as a preliminary. What do we have just now? And I noticed that you've got on, I think it's 2B, you've got a list of what should be on that database. And I would also put on it dog control notices, because then you would have, as it were, a biography of that dog. You know, where it came from, who acquired it, the owner, the veterinary practitioners, and whether there was ever a dog control notice. It keeps you in touch, because at the end of the day, we're not, the dogs are not to blame for any of this, or the puppies. It's the people who acquire them and who then have them for the next 15, 16 years. You can have a wonderful relationship, or at the other end, it can be dreadful for the animal and sometimes for the owner, though I must admit I'm more concerned about the animal because it's in the weaker position. With regard to the UK, I wrote to the then Lord Douglas Miller, seemed to be a nice man, by the way, got a nice letter back, dated 15th April 2024, about a UK-wide microchipping database. And I don't want to read the whole thing. I think happy to let the committee see this later, but we have recently published our response. It was a consultation about a central database, which is available at cat and dog microchipping consultation, etc., which we committed to introducing a single point of search portal. My officials will be discussing with their counterparts in the devolved administrations the scope to develop the portal on a UK basis. Now, that's in April. We've had a change of government, and we know that one government can't bind another, but it does seem in April that was already in train. And I think what maybe the sense I get of agitating here is to get some pace behind this, some pressure behind it to move on. And so I think when I look at Edward Mountain's amendment, and that would be just see what we've got, first of all, what could we improve, what's here. And next step is how do we make this into a national database on a UK-wide basis?
Would Christine Graham
yeah, of course.
From what you're saying, I have a sense that what would give us more confidence is if the Minister could actually, before Stage 3, take some steps forward in the microchipping work at a UK level and bring that back to us before Stage 3 so that we are certain that something is actually going ahead.
Indeed, and I mean, I know it's hard for ministers. They've got, I mean, I'm going to be sympathetic here, as they've got, you know, heavy-duty portfolio, but if you don't set yourself some kind of timescale in tandem with the UK government, then the long grass just gets even longer. So, you know, I'm not saying to the minister you can do this on your own. You can't. But what can be done is, in discussions with the UK government, after this, oh, this is a good egg thing, is to say to the new minister, don't know who it is, at the UK level, this was the position was then, let's get on with this, get our officials together, move on towards a UK microchipping dog database, because obviously if people move their animals about the UK, the best is probably the best we could do. But in the meantime, I think the position that Edward Mountain takes about, let's see what we've got just now, whether it's working, whether people update it, I'm sure they don't, and all the things on it is a good first step. As I say, I don't have a vote in this, but I'm really pleased that there's momentum behind something I've been pushing for a very long time, which is to get this microchipping database. And excuse me, on a very frivolous note, I take it the chicken's name doesn't go in the database, it's just given a number. But if it's got a name, I'd love to hear it. Don't tell me its name is Hen. That's me concluded.
Edward Mountain, to wind up and press our withdrawal amendment 59.
Thank you, Convener. And I guess we're all thankful of the 14.5 million chickens that are in Scotland aren't all kept individually on farms or separate locations. There are only 680,000 dogs in Scotland, so it would make a database very easy to record and to keep on track of. Now, I am absolutely surprised that the Minister doesn't want to find out what we're talking about when it comes to having a central UK database, because I will in just a minute, Minister, because if you are going to change the 2016 Act on microchipping into one central database, you'll require subordinate legislation, and I'd be very surprised if the committee that considered that didn't look to see whether you carried out any consultation. Minister, I'll give way to you.
Yeah, the amendment that you're talking about would actually impose there's a specific new approach. It hasn't been consulted on in any detail during the progress of this bill, and it raises a lot of complex issues which require a much more detailed consideration. And this bill was never intended as a vehicle for a microchipping database reform in the first place. So this isn't the bill to do it, but we're already working on getting that cooperation with the UK government.
So if you're, I thank the Minister for that. I mean, of course, the title of the bill gives me the scope to bring it in, the welfare of dogs, which is what I'm talking about and keen to ensure. Yes, just a moment, if I may. And yes, I'm delighted that you are having friendly chats with people, but if you are going to change the legislation in 3 years' time, you will be required to give evidence to the committee that considers that legislation, who you've consulted and what evidence you've taken, or I'd be surprised if you weren't. Convener, I'll give way to Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you. Thanks to Edward Mountain for giving way. I think that Jim Fairley finds himself in quite a paradoxical position, because whilst agreeing that the government remove part two, the pathway to removing that is to create position where we can look at traceability with confidence, and that is the crux of this bill. It's understanding, you know, where those dogs have gone or pets have gone, and understanding the welfare and the traceability of those is really important to this. So I also want to raise the point that my friend and colleague may have picked up, is that Gillian Martin had also said that in 2022, which I think is what Christine Graham is referring to, that there had been discussions between the Scottish government and the UK Conservative government at the time about a consistent approach. So if the conversations were had in 2022, why haven't they been progressed, and why does the minister not know what progression had been made from that initial conversation in 2022?
Thank you for that intervention. I mean, it is a very interesting question, and of course I can't answer it because I'm not privy to all the papers, but that's why this amendment, which would require the government to action something within 3 years, is entirely apposite for the minister to commit to. And I struggle as I sit here to understand why the minister is reticent about doing this, reticent about preparing, yes, I will take an intervention, preparing the way for a change to the 2016 microchipping legislation.
I can only reiterate, and again, I'm going to push back on the idea that what we're doing is having friendly chit-chats. We're restarting the monthly meetings that the Scottish Government and DEFRA are having, and those meetings are starting tomorrow, which is something that was sorely missed given the previous administration's reticence to actually get engaged. The new government are engaging with us, which would allow us to take the UK system forward. And I reiterate again, this was not the bill to introduce new legislation on microchipping. This was a welfare of dogs bill, and we are doing this stage by stage. And I think these amendments are not in the right place.
And I hear the Minister, and I thank him for his comments. I actually think putting a deadline behind this is really important, because it helps focus the Minister's mind. And in relation to Emma Harper's bill on the dangerous dogs, which I took very seriously and considered in the Ray Committee, one of the things that we found, there was no way to register the dogs and check the registration of them. So I'm sure she'll be supporting this, because it feeds nicely into the bill that she's brought forward. And Ms. Harper, of course, will allow you in.
Yeah, no, but thanks for that. I've been thinking about that, and in my livestock attacks legislation by out-of-control dogs, we did pursue the potential to have a wider database that would be national. And at that time, we decided not to pursue that within the bill, knowing that down the line there will be revision to current legislation. So I actually agree with the Minister that this bill isn't the place to put this microchip further legislation. I think we need to allow the process to take its course.
I hear Ms. Harper, and I'm disappointed to note that. I think I've made my case on why this amendment is good for dogs, good for the welfare of dogs, good for the government, and good for puppies. And I would just say, as a final comment, Convener, is what I find interesting is there are approved databases in Scotland which we can use, which vets in Scotland will be using. But there are just 2 seconds, I don't know if I've got time. I think I was winding up. There are databases approved for use in Scotland. It doesn't mean that dogs coming in from other countries where some of these puppy farms can be are databases that would be approved in Scotland. And I think, Convener, I'll leave it there rather than boring the committee. It's up to the convener.
I think Mr. Mountain has the last word in this debate. I think he's wound up. I just need to ask you whether you're pressing or withdrawing.
I wish to
59.
Continue pressing that amendment.
Thank you. So the question is that amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. And those members wishing to abstain. The result of the vote is 4-4, 5 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 79 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 59. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 79 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those members supporting the amendment, please raise your hand now. Those members not supporting the amendment. Those members abstaining. And the result of the vote is 2-4-7 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 78 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 59. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 78 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those supporting the amendment, please raise your hands now. Those members opposed the amendment. Those members abstaining. And the result of the vote is 3-4-6 against. The amendment has therefore not been agreed. I call Amendment 54 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 64. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 55 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 10. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call Amendment 56 in the name of Christine Graham, already debated with Amendment 7. Christine Graham, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 56 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 57 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
And the question is that Amendment 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 58 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We all agreed. That ends stage two consideration of the bill. It now suspend this meeting.